यू आर लाइव नाउ।
गुड इवनिंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, इट इज माय प्राउड प्रिविलेज टू अनाउंस दैट वी हैव अ लाइव वेबिनार टुडे टाइटल्ड हीमोफीलिया डायग्नोसिस एंड मैनेजमेंट व्हिच इज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय द हीमोफीलिक वेलफेयर सोसाइटी मंडी इन एसोसिएशन विद डॉक्टर राधाकृष्णन गवर्नमेंट मेडिकल कॉलेज हमीरपुर एंड NHM हिमाचल प्रदेश। फॉर टुडेज वेबिनार वी हैव गॉट डॉक्टर अनिता राधाकृष्णन हु इज एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर एट द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ पीडियाट्रिक हेमाटो ऑन्कोलॉजी सुपर स्पेशलिस्ट पीडियाट्रिक हॉस्पिटल एंड पीजी ट्रेनिंग इंस्टीट्यूट एट नोएडा। We also have Dr. Girish Kumar Sharma, who is the Assistant Professor of Pediatrics at Dr. Radhakrishnan Government Medical College, Hamirpur. And in the third speaker for today is Dr. Resham Singh, who is the State Program Officer, Blood Bank and Blood Cell Disorders, National Health Mission, Himachal Pradesh. The closing remarks will be given by the General Secretary of the Hemophilics Welfare Society, Mr. Thakur Samar Singh Parashar. So without wasting further time, I request Dr. Neeta to please start her presentation, ma'am.
Okay, sorry. I hope you can see the slide now. Yeah. So good evening, everybody. Thank you for this opportunity. I work in this government institute in Noida. So this institute was set up in 2017. So now it is called the Postgraduate Institute of Child Health. So it's a pediatric institute. So we predominantly see pediatric patients, but we have, since there are no facilities for hemophilics in that districts otherwise for adult patients, so we are seeing adults as well. So currently, as of end of last year, we have registered around 328 hemophilic A and 86 hemophilia B. We have around 55 patients with inhibitor positive patients. Most of them are high titer inhibitors, as in 854 are high titer inhibitors. Two are hemophilia B with inhibitors, and the rest are hemophilia A with inhibitors. We have other bleeding disorders like von Willebrand disease and rare bleeding disorders like factor 13 deficiency, children with factor 7 deficiency, etc. So whatever I'm going to discuss, I'll try and keep it more practical, whatever problems that we are facing. So we started from scratch in 2017, and with the help of National Health Mission, we have been able to set up services. And our center, this is an old map from 2019. We have been basically catering to patients from Western UP as well as patients from neighboring states as well. So we have a hemophilia daycare center. So this is with the help of National Health Mission and the hemophilia societies in Delhi and Noida, we've been able to get this center up and working. And we have help in manpower from National Health Mission. In addition to the daycare services, we provide 24-hour services for our patients who come to us. So anytime anybody can walk in with a bleed, we have been able to provide treatment for them. So what will we discuss today? We will discuss how hemophilia patients come to us usually, and how not to miss a bleed. Many a times children jo bahar suspicion leke jaate hain, even pediatric hospitals mein jab jaate hain, kabhi kabhi wo koi aur disease hai soch ke uske liye treatment leke aa jaate hain. तो वो प्रॉब्लम कैसे नहीं होना है, हाउ टू नॉट मिस अ ब्लीड, दैट इज समथिंग वी विल सी स्पेसिफिकली. इफ वी आर सस्पेक्टिंग हीमोफीलिया, हाउ टू डायग्नोस हीमोफीलिया, और उसमें भी क्या गलतियां हो सकती है. कभी कभी जो सैंपल जो रिपोर्ट्स लेके आते हैं, हम जनरली जब हमारे सेंटर में टेस्ट करते हैं तो रिपोर्ट थोड़ा डिफरेंट आते हैं, तो वो क्यों हुआ और उसको कैसे हम अवॉइड कर सकते हैं, दैट विल ऑल्सो बी सीन. देन वंस वी हैव डायग्नोस्ड एंड मेड severity classification, also we have decided on what is the severity, how do you treat hemophilia, so what are the practical aspects of calculating clotting factors, etc., that we will see. And very important, when we run a center, we need to monitor the progress of our patients, because जब तक आपका पेशेंट ठीक नहीं हो रहा, ये सब करने का कोई मतलब नहीं है ना। तो पिछले 2017 में जो पेशेंट आए वो 18 में कैसे रहा, 19 में कैसे रहा, वो जानकारी बहुत जरूरी है। सो हमारी मॉनिटरिंग कैसे होनी चाहिए और हमारे रिकॉर्ड कीपिंग कैसे होनी चाहिए, इसके बारे में भी थोड़ा सा हम डिस्कस करेंगे। सो जस्ट फॉर इनिशिएटिंग द डिस्कशन, सो हम वी ऑल नो दैट देयर आर दीस टाइप्स ऑफ हीमोस्टेसिस। जब भी थोड़ा सा कट लग जाती है, वी हैव अ साइट ऑफ इंजुरी, देन देयर इज अ वैसो कंस्ट्रक्शन एट दैट साइट, एंड देयर इज दिस एंडोथेलियल इंजुरी। व्हेनेवर देयर इज एंडोथेलियल इंजुरी, देयर इज वॉन विलिब्रन फैक्टर व्हिच इज प्रेजेंट इन द सब एंडोथेलियल मैट्रिक्स दैट गेट्स एक्सपोज टू द शियर फ्लो ऑफ ब्लड। When the von Willebrand factor gets exposed, so then that causes addition of platelets on its surface. So this part, the first part of this thing is called the primary phase of hemostasis. Jo von Willebrand factor, jo red dots yahan dikh rahi hai, that is von Willebrand factor. On top of that, initially platelets come and stick to it. That is called addition of platelets. And on top of that, these platelets, when they adhere, they become activated and they make more platelets adhere on top of it. So that is called aggregation. So this is the first part of this, is a platelet plug formation. So a platelet plug formation is not enough to form a good clot. Platelet plug will be like this. It will be like a sieve, chhanni ke jaisa hoga. तो है थोड़ा बहुत बेनिफिट होगा, मतलब बहुत ज्यादा ब्लीडिंग तो शायद शायद नहीं होगा, पर वो काफी नहीं है। यू नीड टू मेक दैट क्लॉट मोर स्ट्रांग, एंड फॉर दैट वी हैव व्हाट इज कॉल्ड द सेकेंडरी पार्ट ऑफ हीमोस्टेसिस। एंड दैट सेकेंडरी पार्ट ऑफ हीमोस्टेसिस वी नीड लॉट ऑफ फैक्टर्स, यू नीड क्लॉटिंग फैक्टर्स और क्लॉटिंग फैक्टर्स विच आर देयर इन योर बॉडी, एंड दीज क्लॉटिंग फैक्टर्स टूगेदर स्टेप बाय स्टेप देयर इज अ प्रोसेस ऑफ एक्टिवेशन ऑफ दीज क्लॉटिंग फैक्टर्स, एंड दैट रिजल्ट्स इन फॉर्मेशन ऑफ व्हाट इज कॉल्ड द फाइब्रिन क्लॉट। सो दैट इज अ secondary part of hemostasis, and once you have the fibrin and stabilization of fibrin, you have a very good clot. Now that does not, even the hemostasis process does not stop there. Aapka clot ban gaya, so that clot should not stay there more than it is needed. After a clot is formed here, that endothelial injury gets repaired after a while. So once that repair happens, that clot should also dissolve and disappear. So body has that mechanism also. So it causes dissolution of the fibrin clot after a while. When it is no longer required, that clot dissolves on its own. And the clot also does not spread to normal areas normally because of this normal hemostasis in the body. That is called tertiary hemostasis. So these are the three parts of a clot formation. Now, what is abnormal in hemophilia? The secondary part of hemostasis. We do not have some clotting factors. So hemophilia A and hemophilia B are two diseases where two different clotting factors are not there in the body. What happens in von Willebrand disease? In von Willebrand disease, there is defect in both primary and secondary hemostasis. Primary because we remember that this von Willebrand factor had to attach the platelets on its surface. So that part is not working. And secondary why? Because von Willebrand factor carries factor VIII on its surface. So whenever there is deficiency of von Willebrand factor, there will be defect in a platelet, defect of factor VIII also, because factor VIII is degraded very quickly. So this is the cascade model which we all learned. I'll just quickly go through it and just show some salient points in it. So this is not actually what happens in the body, but still for ease of remembering, this pathway is still helpful. So we have two tests mainly to test the coagulation pathway. One is called prothrombin time and another one is called activated partial thromboplastin time. What is prothrombin time test? It tests whatever is there in this lilac bubble as well as this blue one. So what is there? Here factor 7 is there. So this is the extrinsic pathway and this is the common pathway. So PT tests the tests extrinsic plus common pathway, whereas APTT tests the intrinsic plus common pathway. And what is there in APTT pathway? There are so many factors important, but so many factors written here. But what is important in here is basically factor 8, which is down here, and factor 9. These are the two most important factors in this pathway. Some amount of factor 11 also is important, because factor 11 deficiency, we rarely see that also. It's a rare bleeding disorder and that also can present with bleeding. But whatever is up there, above that factor 11, that is factor 12, prekallikrein, high molecular weight kininogen, all of them are not clinically important for bleeding. But it can cause some other problems, but it's not important for bleeding. So we should remember that one patient, when they come with APTT prolongation, it is usually 8 and 9, whereas PET prolongation, it is usually 7. What is the common pathway? Common pathway, you have again 4 factors here, which is important. Most important is 10. Then you have prothrombin, then you have factor 5, and then you have fibrinogen. So these are the 4 important factors here. And here also, if this is abnormal, you can see both of them are dependent on this. So both these tests actually test the common pathway. So if you have deficiency of, say, I told there is a factor, if you have a patient with a factor 5 deficiency, for example, that child will present with both PT and APTT prolongation. So both PT, APTT prolongation, it could be anything in the common pathway, whereas only prothrombin time prolongation, then only factor 7 deficiency, and only APTT prolongation, it would be usually either factor 8 or factor 9 deficiency. So these are the parts of the secondary hemostasis. Now what happens in the body is little different from this. There are other ways of doing this, and this was discovered a couple of decades back. And it's physiologically, this is the pathway that happens. But still, for our ease of understanding, this is still important to know that what is PT pathway and what is the intrinsic and extrinsic pathway. Now, when a person has hemophilia, yeah, you could have either hemophilia A or you could have hemophilia B. And like I said, among the clotting factors, if you have factor A deficiency, you have hemophilia A. And if you have 9 deficiency, you have hemophilia B. Are they very common disorders? No. What is the incidence? In our country, hemophilia A is to the tune of 1 in 5,000 male births. So, ek saal mein kitne bhi bache paida ho rahe, usme se ladke jitne paida ho rahe, usme se 5,000 mein ek bache ko hemophilia A. तो अगर ऐसे इस कैलकुलेशन से अगर हम कैलकुलेट करेंगे, हर साल हमारे पास 15,000 इस तौर पे बच्चे होनी चाहिए, डायग्नोज होनी चाहिए. बिकॉज हमारा जो यूनिसेफ के हिसाब से जो हमारे कंट्री में कितने बर्थ्स होती है, उसके हिसाब से अगर हम कैलकुलेट करेंगे तो मिनिमम 10 to 12,000 चिल्ड्रन शुड बी बॉर्न विथ हीमोफीलिया ए इन आवर कंट्री एवरी ईयर. ऐसे होती है, होती होगी, हमें नहीं पता, बट हमारे पास डायग्नोज जरूर नहीं हो रही है. क्यों? क्योंकि छोटे उम्र में ही हो सके वो कहीं से गिर गए, कहीं कुछ ब्लीडिंग हुआ, हॉस्पिटल पहुंचे, कभी डायग्नोसिस ही नहीं हुआ. और डायग्नोसिस इतने कम हो रहे हैं क्योंकि इन होल कंट्री में हमारे पास आज के दिन में लगभग 22,000 पेशेंट्स है रजिस्टर्ड. तो इतने सालों से जो रजिस्ट्री चल रही है या सोसाइटीज चल रही है, जिसके हिसाब से हमारे अवेयरनेस के हिसाब से हमें पेशेंट नंबर्स एक्चुअली बढ़नी चाहिए थे, पर उतना नहीं बढ़ी हुई है. तो प्रॉबेबली ये बच्चे डायग्नोस नहीं हो रहे, या विलेजेस में कुछ ब्लीडिंग हुआ, जैसे अभी हिली एरियाज में है, तो अगर कुछ दिक्कत हुआ, जब तक एक अच्छे सेंटर में पहुंच के टेस्ट कराए, पीटी एपीटीटी टेस्ट कराने के लिए भी मुश्किल होती है, तो वो उस इन प्रॉब्लम्स की वजह से मेजॉरिटी डायग्नोस नहीं होते. और होते हैं तो भी जहां डायग्नोस हो रही है वहां से इलाज करने में भी दिक्कत हो रही होगी, और इलाज नहीं मिल रही होगी, या रजिस्ट्री में रजिस्टर होने से पहले ही डेथ हो रही होगी. ऐसे बहुत सारे रीजंस के वजह से हमारे पास पेशेंट्स बहुत कम डायग्नोस होती है. और हीमोफीलिया बी और भी कम है, 1 in 30,000 मेल बर्थ्स है, और उस हिसाब से लगभग 800-900 बच्चे होनी चाहिए हर साल, पर इतना बिल्कुल नहीं है. बच्चे क्योंकि ये एक्सलिंग डिसऑर्डर है, बाई मेल्स आर अफेक्टेड. फीमेल्स साइड से आती है जरूर, बट फीमेल्स यूजुअली कैरियर्स में जनरली सिम्टम्स ज्यादा नहीं होते, बट सम कैरियर सिम्टोमेटिक होते. सो बहुत सारे बच्चों की मदर्स, उनको अगर वो कैरियर है, और उनमें से कुछ लोगों को ब्लीडिंग टेंडेंसी रह सकती है, तो आपको जब हम देखते हैं उनसे भी पूछना जरूरी होते हैं. कभी कभार ब्लीडिंग फीमेल में ज्यादा हो सकती है, तो वो क्यों होती है? 2-3 वजह है फिजियोलॉजी में, जिस वजह से हम वो एक्सप्लेन कर सकते हैं. समटाइम्स अगर स्क्यूड इनएक्टिवेशन बोलते हैं, तो यू हैव अ चाइल्ड हु इज बॉर्न विद एक्स बॉर्न फीमेल, एक्स क्रोमोसोम डिफेक्टिव है, दूसरा एक्स क्रोमोसोम नॉर्मल है आपका. जब एक एक्स क्रोमोसोम नॉर्मल है, यूजुअली उसी से जितना फैक्टर बन रही है वो काफी रहेगा, बट बॉडी हैज दिस प्रोसेस कॉल्ड रैंडम इनएक्टिवेशन. एक एक्स क्रोमोसोम बॉडी में जनरली इनएक्टिवेट हो जाती है, वो नॉर्मली हम सब में हो रही है. तो कभी कभार ये जो नॉर्मल एक्स क्रोमोसोम जब इनएक्टिवेट होती है, फिर जो एबनॉर्मल एक्स रह गई है उससे फैक्टर नहीं बन पाती, तो उसको रैंडम इनएक्टिवेशन बोलते हैं. कभी कभार एक डिजीज है टर्नर सिंड्रोम। टर्नर सिंड्रोम में एक ही एक्स होती है, गर्ल चाइल्ड है बट एक ही एक्स क्रोमोसोम में, दूसरे साइड में नहीं है कुछ। तो उस वजह से भी उन बच्चों में भी अगर वो एक्स क्रोमोसोम में डिजीज है तो उनमें भी वो अफेक्ट हो सकते हैं। तो फीमेल्स अफेक्टेड हो सकते हैं हीमोफीलिया से। ज्यादातर जब ब्लीडिंग लेके आते हैं फीमेल्स, इट इज यूजली वॉन वे लिवरेन डिजीज या कोई रेयर ब्लीडिंग डिसऑर्डर्स होंगे, जैसे 7 हो, 5 हो, बाकी जो रेयर डिसऑर्डर्स होती है फैक्टर 13, ये सब ऑटोसोमल रिसेसिव है। तो उसमें यू कुड हैव मेल एंड फीमेल सब इक्वली अफेक्ट होती है। तो उस जनरली अगर विमेन ब्लीडर है तो यूजली इनमें ही कुछ होती है, बट फैक्टर 8 या फैक्टर 9 डेफिशिएंसी अनकॉमन नहीं है। मेरे सेंटर में भी एक बच्ची है जो हीमोफीलिया बी ही है, प्रूवन हीमोफीलिया बी, जेनेटिकली प्रूवन ऑल्सो, एंड दैट इज वंस इन अ वाइल वी सी सच चिल्ड्रन ऑल्सो। नाउ जब फैक्टर की कमी होती है, नॉर्मली हमारे बॉडी में फैक्टर रहता है रफली अराउंड 80 to 100, 120% तक फैक्टर रहती है। जब कम होने लग जाती है, जब लेस देन 1% होती है, उसी को हम सिवियर हीमोफीलिया बोलते हैं। लेस देन 1% मीन्स आइदर द बॉडी इज कंप्लीटली नॉट प्रोड्यूसिंग, 0% और वेरी स्मॉल परसेंटेज, 0.5%, 0.6%, ऐसे फैक्टर लेवल्स होती है। तो लेस देन 1% इज कॉल्ड सिवियर हीमोफीलिया, 1 to 5% is called moderate hemophilia, and when you have 5 to 30%, that is called mild hemophilia. ये mild में थोड़ा variation होती है, कुछ लोग 5 to 40% भी उसको बोलते हैं। Why do we need to know the severity? Severe, very severe disease, that is less than 1% disease, where practically there is no factor is formed in the body, these children can have spontaneous bleeding. आप कुछ भी नहीं करोगे, आराम से बैठे रहेंगे तो भी आपके दिमाग में भी ब्लीडिंग हो सकती है। तो वो वाला सिवियरिटी इन बच्चों में हो सकती है। तो इसलिए हम फैमिली को पहले ही काउंसिल करते हैं कि ध्यान रखना है, गिरना नहीं है, जितना हमसे हो सकता है प्रिवेंट करने के लिए, ब्लीड प्रिवेंट कर सकते हैं जितना हम प्रिवेंट कर सकते हैं उतना हमें ध्यान रखना ही है। स्पेशली छोटे उम्र में बच्चा बिस्तर से नहीं गिरना चाहिए। बिस्तर से गिरना, डेस्क के कोना लगना, ये सब नॉर्मल वेरी कॉमन ब्लीड इंजरीज होती है। जैसे खेलने गया, कहीं बॉल लग गया, तो ये सारा चीज हम प्रिवेंट कर सकते हैं। दे हो गया सिवियर। सिवियर में क्या होता है, कुछ भी नहीं करो तो भी स्पॉन्टेनियस ब्लीड होंगे। रात को सोने गए, बच्चे को कुछ दिक्कत नहीं था, अगले दिन सुबह उठे एल्बो में ब्लीड है। तो ये कॉमनली देखा जाता है और पेरेंट्स भी पहले पहले बहुत ही गिल्ट फील करते हैं कि मैंने ध्यान नहीं दिया इसलिए ब्लीडिंग हुआ। तो हम उनको भी यही बताते हैं कि आपने आपको ध्यान रखना है, पर अगर ब्लीड हुआ तो वो किसी की गलती की वजह से नहीं है, ना बच्चे की गलती है ना पेरेंट की गलती है। इसमें स्पॉन्टेनियस ब्लीड्स होती है और ब्लीड होते हैं तो आप आ जाओ, फैक्टर लगा के जाओ, यही काउंसिल करते हैं। मॉडरेट में क्या डिफरेंस है, मॉडरेट में ब्लीडिंग फ्रीक्वेंसी थोड़ा कम है, स्पॉन्टेनियस ब्लीड्स कम है, चोट लगने के बाद ब्लीडिंग होने का चांसेस ज्यादा है, और अगर कोई सर्जरी वगैरह हो रही है, कोई यहीं पे कट लग जाती है उसमें से जरूर ब्लीडिंग होगी, दांत निकाल दिया, इन सब ऐसे चीजों में ब्लीडिंग होगी जरूर। एंड माइल्ड में और कम हो जाती है, तो प्रॉब्ली साल में एक बार आना पड़ता है उनको फैक्टर लगाने के लिए, या कभी कभी 2-3 साल ही नहीं आते, कुछ भी नहीं हुआ उनको, ऐसे पेशेंट्स होते हैं। इनका कोई सर्जरी, मेजर सर्जरी, कभी अपेंडिक्स निकालना पड़ा या फिर कोई एक्सीडेंट हो गया, उसके बाद चोट लग गया तब ब्लीडिंग हुआ, ऐसे चीजों में ही इनको पकड़ में आती है। वो ज्यादातर पेशेंट्स को पता भी नहीं चलता कि उनके अंडर ब्लीडिंग टेंडेंसी है। कब चोट वोट लगने में नीले निशान आते होंगे, बट देन दे डोंट कम टू द हॉस्पिटल फॉर दैट, सो जनरली दे आर डायग्नोस्ड क्वाइट लेट। सो सिवियर, माइल्ड और मॉडरेट, ये पता करना हमारे लिए बहुत जरूरी है, बिकॉज उसके हिसाब से ही हम उनको आगे समझाते हैं, उनके ट्रीटमेंट वगैरह में हम आगे उनको समझाते हैं। तो अगर माइल्ड है तो बस ट्रॉमा प्रिवेंट करना है और अगर ब्लीड है तो आना है। मॉडरेट और सिवियर में ट्रॉमा जरूर प्रिवेंट करना है, ब्लीड है तो आके ट्रीटमेंट देनी है, और सिवियर में ब्लीड नहीं है तो भी प्रोफिलैक्सिस ट्रीटमेंट लेना बेहतर है, तो ये भी हम उनको समझाते हैं। तो दिस इज द सिवियरिटी ऑफ हीमोफीलिया। नाउ हीमोफीलिया में हमेशा कैरियर मदर नहीं होते हैं, मैंने बोला है एक्स क्रोमोसोम से डिजीज आती है। तो जब भी एक्स क्रोमोसोम, ये नॉर्मल फादर है जिनके एक्स और वाई में डिजीज नहीं है, ये मदर में आप देखिएगा जो छोटा एक्स है जो पिंक कलर में है तो वो एली अफेक्टेड एलील है। तो इनमें से एक एक्स, एक साइड में एक फादर का एलील और एक मदर का एलील मिलके बच्चे होते हैं। तो अगर ये बॉय हुआ, बॉय मतलब वाई क्रोमोसोम फादर से मिली है ना, तो एक्स क्रोमोसोम मदर से आई है, तो इनमें जो एक्स क्रोमोसोम आई है वो नॉर्मल वाली आई है, वेरस इसमें इसमें भी वाई फादर से आई है, पर जो एक्स दूसरा आया है वो मदर से आई है। तो ये बच्चा क्योंकि एक ही एक्स है और वो एक्स खराब है, इस वजह से ये हीमोफीलिया जरूर प्रेजेंट करने वाला है। बाकी नॉर्मल डॉटर हो सकती है, अगर फादर से एक्स मिल रहा है और मदर से नॉर्मल एक्स मिलेंगे तो नॉर्मल डॉटर हो गई, और फादर से नॉर्मल एक्स मिल रही है, वैसे भी नॉर्मल एक्स मिल रहे फादर से, बट क्या मदर से अगर ये वाली एक्स मिल रही है जो छोटे वाले एक्स है, तो ये बेबी कैरियर डॉटर बन सकती है। तो अगर मदर कैरियर है, लड़के होंगे तो लड़कियों में 50% चांस रहेगा कि हिमोफीलिया आए उनमें, और लड़कियां होंगे तो लड़कियों में 50% चांस रहेंगे कि वो कैरियर स्टेटस होंगे उनमें। तो जनरली जब हम कैसे देख रहे हैं, हम इस पेशेंट को देख रहे हैं, हमारे पास ये पेशेंट आया पहली बार, हो सके इनके पास कोई फैमिली हिस्ट्री ना हो, और मोस्टली पेरेंट्स के पास भी कोई हिस्ट्री नहीं होगा, लेकिन मदर को ही, मदर को कोई ब्लीडिंग वीडिंग नहीं होगा। तो हमें क्या क्या पूछना होती है, पहली चीज हमारे फर्स्ट कॉन्टैक्ट में जनरली ये सब डिस्कशन नहीं लाना चाहिए, क्योंकि पेरेंट्स बहुत एंग्शियस होते हैं उस टाइम पे। व्हेन यू इनिशिएट सच डिस्कशंस ना, वो जनरली मदर के खिलाफ जाता है, और मदर के लिए फिर ऐसे फैमिलीज है जिसमें फैमिली ब्रेकअप हो गई है बिकॉज फादर स्टार्टेड एक्यूसिंग की मदर के साइड से बीमारी आई है। तो ये ऐसे डिस्कशन हम जनरली फर्स्ट एक दो बार बात ही नहीं करते, धीरे धीरे समझाते हैं उनको कि हो सके ये मदर से आई हो, और मदर के फैमिली हिस्ट्री पूछेंगे, और फैमिली हिस्ट्री में जनरली पूछती हूँ तो दोनों साइड से पूछती हूँ, ताकि ऐसे फादर को नहीं लगना चाहिए कि उनके साइड से बिल्कुल नहीं आएंगे करके, तो दोनों साइड से पूछती हूँ और एक ही जैसे पूछती हूँ। और मदर साइड में भी ये भी पूछते हैं कि मदर के ब्रदर्स, क्योंकि एक्सलिंग हिस्ट्री है तो मैटरनल साइड पूछना जरूरी है, तो मैटरनल साइड में मैटरनल ब्रदर्स, मैटरनल अंकल्स, इन सबको कहीं कभी पे भी प्रॉब्लम हुआ है कि नहीं, और मदर का फादर अफेक्टेड। तो ये तीन लोग, मदर्स फादर, मदर्स अंकल एंड मदर्स ब्रदर्स, ये तीन लोग अफेक्टेड है कि नहीं, हमें पता करना जरूरी है। और धीरे धीरे आगे आगे जब मीटिंग होती रहेंगी हम इन ये सब भी पूछ लेते हैं। और उनको सबसे जरूरी एक चीज बतानी है कि एक बार हो गया अभी, पर अगले बार आप प्रेग्नेंट होने से पहले हमें बता दीजिएगा, क्योंकि हमें बहुत सारी चीजें आगे आपको समझानी होगी। हमें पहली बार ये पता करनी होगी कि ये मदर कैरियर है कि नहीं, और अगर कैरियर है तो इनका आगे प्रीनेटल डायग्नोसिस करना जरूरी है, नहीं तो हो सके नेक्स्ट प्रेगनेंसी में भी यही सब चीज रिपीट हो सकती है ना। तो हम सेंटर वाले में दो फैमिलीज ऐसे हैं जिसमें तीन बच्चे अफेक्टेड हैं, तीन बच्चे हीमोफिलिक लेके आते हैं, और ऐसे लगभग तीन चार फैमिलीज और हैं जिसमें दो दो बच्चे अफेक्टेड हैं। तो जब तक हम लोग देख रहे हैं ऑलरेडी इनका डायग्नोसिस हो चुकी है या ऑलरेडी बच्चा पैदा हो चुकी है, इसलिए मिस हो रही है। और कभी कभार ऐसे भी होती है कि बच्चा हुआ, अगले बेबी प्रेग्नेंट होने के टाइम पे उन्होंने हमें बताया भी नहीं है, और अगला प्रेगनेंसी डिलीवर होने के बाद सर्कमसिशन करने पे वो बेबी ब्लीड करके शॉक में लाए हुए स्टेट भी है। तो ऐसे भी होते हैं कि इतना सब समझाने के बाद भी कुछ लोग थोड़ा सा इसको लाइटली लेते हैं। तो समझाना बहुत जरूरी है कि प्रेग्नेंट होते ही हमें बतानी है, और हमें ये बेबी का जेनेटिक टेस्टिंग करके पहले से रेडी रखना जरूरी है। तो ये सारा चीज, इसका प्रोसेस होती है प्रीनेटल की, वो जनरली अच्छे से हम समझाते हैं, इतना मुश्किल भी नहीं है आज के दिन में कराना। तो ये हो गया इनहेरिटेंस के पैटर्न पे। अब हम देखेंगे पेशेंट्स हमारे पास कैसे आएंगे। तो ज्यादातर बच्चे ब्रूजिंग, मतलब नीले नीले निशान के साथ आने वाले हैं। तो ये ऐसे बहुत ही नॉटी बच्चे होते हैं, इधर उधर कूदते होते हैं और यहाँ पे निशान ब्लीडिंग लेके आ जाते हैं। फिर क्या आते हैं, हम बच्चों को कस के पकड़ते हैं छोटे एज में ना, जैसे आप देख सकते हो यहाँ पे एक नीले निशान है और यहाँ पे एक ब्रूज है ना, और हो सके हाथ में भी हो, यहाँ थोड़ा स्वेलिंग दिख रही है। तो ये बेबी को अगर उठाने में, कभी कभी ऐसे पकड़ के उठाने में एकदम से टाइटली पकड़ने में ब्लू स्पॉट्स आती है। ये छोटा बेबी है, लगभग प्रॉब्ली 2 मंथ 3 मंथ ओल्ड बेबी होगा, तो उतने जल्दी भी पिकअप होती है। इमीडिएट न्यूबॉर्न पीरियड में यूजली सिम्टम्स नहीं होती है, या ऐसे ही सिम्टम्स शुरू होती है। कभी कभी बच्चे को, छोटे बेबी को भी हम ऐसे एल्बो से पकड़ के उठाते हैं तो भी आपको ब्लीडिंग के रिस्क हो सकते हैं। इसके अलावा क्या ब्लीड हो सकती है, सबसे कॉमन ब्लीड है मस्कुलोस्केलेटल ब्लीड्स। अराउंड 80% ऑफ ब्लीड्स पेशेंट्स का जॉइंट में और मसल्स में होने वाली है और ये एक एग्जाम्पल ऑफ अ रियली बैड स्टेटस है। इसमें क्या क्या दिक्कतें हैं, एक तो कभी भी इतना बैड सोलन जॉइंट्स होना नहीं चाहिए। जो बच्चे रेगुलरली दिखाते हैं, जो बच्चे फिजियोथेरेपी करेक्टली करते हैं, इन बच्चों का जॉइंट स्टेटस बहुत अच्छा होता है और उसमें ब्लीडिंग फ्रीक्वेंसी कम हो जाती है। जो बच्चे डरते हैं या जो फैमिली डरते हैं ब्लीडिंग से और जिस वजह से फिजियोथेरेपी नहीं कराते, लोगों को एक गलतफहमी होती है कि फिजियोथेरेपी कराएंगे ब्लीडिंग बढ़ जाएगा, और ये बहुत बार समझा समझा के उनको दिखा दिखा के, अब मैं प्रिस्क्रिप्शन में वी राइट डाउन कि हाफ एन आवर ऑफ फिजियोथेरेपी ट्वाइस अ डे, मतलब लाइक अ मेडिसिन वी हैव टू राइट इट डाउन एंड टेल देम दैट यू हैव टू डू फिजियोथेरेपी, ओनली देन दे हैव एडहियर टू इट। एंड आई मेक दम सिट इन द ओपीडी, वो स्क्वाटिंग पोजिशन में बिठा के उठा के दिखाती हूँ ताकि वो हिप नी और एल्बो हिप नी और एंकल की कंट्रैक्चर्स हम डेमोन्स्ट्रेट कर सकते हैं पेरेंट्स को कि ये नहीं होनी चाहिए, है ना। तो जनरली जो बच्चे अच्छे से फिजियोथेरेपी करते हैं उनको जॉइंट्स में दिक्कत नहीं होती है। एक्यूट हिमार्थ्रोसिस, एक्यूट ब्लीड होते हैं तो आते हैं, फैक्टर लगा के चले जाते हैं। ये बच्चा फॉर एग्जाम्पल दोनों जॉइंट्स स्वोलन है और ये जॉइंट शायद टेंस आर्थराइटिस था, जो ये एक्यूट ब्लीड था, और ये वाले साइड में स्वोलन है, ये पुराना ब्लीड है और इसकी वजह से जो साइनोवियल स्वेलिंग है दैट हैज रिमेन्ड ऑन, सो दैट हैज कंटिन्यूड एज अ साइनोवाइटिस और अ साइनोबॉगी स्वेलिंग। इसमें पेन नहीं होगा, सॉफ्ट स्वेलिंग होगा आपको टच करने में, बट जनरली इसमें भी रेंज ऑफ मूवमेंट्स अफेक्टेड हो सकती है, पेनफुल नहीं होगा जनरली। तो दैट इज हाउ यू डिफरेंशिएट बिटवीन एन एक्यूट हिमार्थ्रोसिस एंड अ क्रॉनिक हिमार्थ्रोसिस। एक्यूट विल बी पेनफुल, रेंज ऑफ मूवमेंट करते ही बहुत डर लगता है, दर्द होती है और वो बच्चे ही डर जाता है कि नहीं नहीं टच नहीं करना। सो दैट इज हाउ यू डिफरेंशिएट एन एक्यूट ब्लीड फ्रॉम अ क्रॉनिक वन। इस फोटो में और क्या खराबी है, ये सारे मसल्स, यहाँ पे मसल है ही नहीं, यू कैन सी दैट वेस्टिंग ऑफ द क्वाड्रिसेप्स हियर। So this is very very bad. Now why has this happened? Because this child has not done any activity. ये आते हैं, फैक्टर लगाते हैं, घर में जाके बैठ जाते हैं या स्कूल में जाके बैठते हैं, ना एक्सरसाइज करते हैं, डरते हैं, पूरा मूवमेंट होता भी नहीं होगा तो इसलिए और डरते हैं। तो और सालों से एक्सरसाइज ना कर करके ये क्वाड्रिसेप्स मसल्स हैव अंडरगॉन वेस्टिंग। तो वास्टस मीडियालिस स्पेशली और ये जो ऊपर के जो मसल्स होती है, ऑल ऑफ देम अंडरगो वेस्टिंग, एंड व्हाट हैपेंस व्हेन दे अंडरगो वेस्टिंग, द जॉइंट बिकम्स अनस्टेबल, देन यू गेट रिपीटेड ब्लीड्स, एंड सो दैट गोज ऑन, दैट प्रोसेस गोज ऑन लाइक दैट, एंड दिस इज व्हाट कॉसेस डिसेबिलिटी इन आवर पॉपुलेशन। दिस इज व्हाई बाय 18 ईयर्स और 19 ईयर्स ऑफ एज मेजॉरिटी ऑफ चिल्ड्रन आर लिंपिंग, majority of children are many of them have difficulty in climbing stairs or walking without support, and many of them people cannot run, they cannot climb into a metro, they cannot travel unaided, and then some of them end up in a wheelchair, and some of them if they have some or difficulties like you know pseudo tumor etc, they undergo multiple surgeries by now, and some of them even have replacement hip or knee replacements also by now. And this is what we can prevent if we give good factor cover and good physiotherapy from the beginning. So there are many children, if you teach them properly from the beginning, they don't even look like hemophilia. अब वो आते हैं नॉर्मली अपना काम करते चले जाते, उनको फैक्टर भी लगाना हम सिखा देते तो बाय 10 इयर्स 11 इयर्स दे आर हाईली इंडिपेंडेंट एंड दे आर एक्सट्रीमली कॉन्फिडेंट टू डू। वेयर एज जो बच्चे ऐसे आते हैं उनको आने के लिए भी सपोर्ट चाहिए, सीढ़ी एक बार एग्जामिनेशन कोर्ट में चढ़ने के लिए बोलो उसके लिए भी मदद चाहिए, तो दे आर कंप्लीटली they are used to having support all their life. So that has to be changed from the beginning, and that is something which we can do by repeated counseling. So this is joint bleeding. What else can happen? This is another child. So this picture, I don't know if you can see properly. This is a child who has come in with a large scar. Kya hota hai? This boy used to have muscle bleeds. And every time he has a muscle bleed, he goes to an orthopedician. Like because it's a bone or joint related issue, generally people send him to an orthopedician. And every time he underwent either ultrasound or MRI, and every time there was some collection. So they thought it was an abscess. So three times in his life, he underwent surgery for this. Every time they would operate, open, they will find only blood clots, they will remove it. And then post-op period, he will bleed. And then after bleeding, he will receive blood, plasma, etc. No, without any testing. And then that bleeding stops. After a few days, he develops again a swelling. So once the third time it happened, then he was brought to us and he was hemophilia B. And subsequently, he has not had a single joint bleed. Like if you just follow them up properly in physiotherapy, there was no further bleed in this area at all. So these are muscle bleeds and this is joint bleeds. And these are the most common bleeds in patients with hemophilia. What else can we see? We can see children who come with trauma. Once you have trauma, you fall off from a bed, and this is the most dangerous thing because many children come with intracranial hemorrhage. And this boy, I remember particularly, he came with probably the third intracranial bleed, and after this, he could not talk. But it's a very active, bright child, and every time he used to smile and laugh and all and come. But then repeatedly, he got IC bleeds. And he lived in a very remote part. Again, by the time they would reach us, it was day 3 of bleed. And by then we treat and correct. It is usually a life-saving procedure. And you treat and he came in a ventilator also once. So, and he improved and went. But then after the having repeated IC bleeds, you will get sequelae also. And that brain, the sequelae in the third time was that he became aphasic completely. So he still comes occasionally, but and for the last, I think, 2 years or so since COVID started, I have not seen him, but I don't think he has had any IC bleed subsequently. So dangerous thing is that children should not fall from the bed. So where if it's a small baby, you will ask them to keep the child on a floor, on a mattress on the floor with pillows around so that they don't roll over or topple over. Even if they roll over, they don't fall from a height. Staircase should be very, very careful while a child learns how to climb stairs. They should not use walkers at all. All these things have to be counseled to them very regularly. This is again another trauma for face, again fall and hit the head against the face. So these trauma keeps happening. Children come with cuts also, like 2 days also, we had a very deep gash wound on the forehead. And that was again following hit against a table. So these things, some things which we cannot avoid, but we should try our level best. Sometimes even cannula can be dangerous. If it's a chubby baby and you're trying to, for example, child has come with a bruise, you're trying to do some investigation. If you prick blindly, sometimes it can end up in this kind of bleeds. And this doesn't look dangerous right now, but another child I'll show you, that child had a, yeah. So this is an older child. An older child is a diagnosed hemophilic. He went for factor infusion to a center. And at that center, he was pricked here to get the factor infusion. He had a hematoma and he stayed indoors with the hematoma. He thought it will subside after 2 days. By the time he came to us, it was already 4-5 days and he had gangrene which had set in this part. And that had to be multiple episodes of fasciotomy had to be done. So these are extremely dangerous wounds and we should try our level best. And that all the nurses who prick these children should be the most experienced nurses, or you should train our nurse to do pediatric cannulations because cannulas can also be dangerous. And this is another child, like this, the first picture, like the bleed was here, but then again went into compartment syndrome and he had a fasciotomy done at another center. Now this is how his hand looks like. So very disfiguring lesions can happen if we are not very careful. Another bleed is tongue bleeds. Usually hemophilics do not come with oral bleeds as such, but if you have a cut on your tongue or if you have a loose tooth, definitely it will bleed. And this can last for a while. That is another problem, because this lesion, till the time it heals, this lesion is going to say take around a week to heal. By the time it takes to heal, till then the child will continue bleeding. So if you give factor today, you have to tell them that, okay, this factor is going to protect probably for today until tomorrow evening. He can bleed again, so you should bring back. That counseling has to be given to them. Otherwise, they'll get scared. Once the second time bleeding happens, they will get worried again. And again, small children, you should make them lie onto one side, because if at all it bleeds at night, it should go out and he should not aspirate the blood. This is another bleed from a loose tooth. You can see a huge hematoma here. And other than this, couple of dangerous bleeds are psoas bleeding, renal bleeding, and intracranial bleeding. So why are intracranial these bleeds bad? So life-threatening bleeds are oral bleeds like this, CNS bleeds, renal bleeds, and GI bleed, because these bleeds can result in death. Because if you don't know, if you do this kind of a bleed, if the blood is aspirated, it can cause a sudden respiratory arrest. CNS bleeds, if you don't recognize it early, these children are going to have raised ICT and they die. And many a time CNS bleeds start with what? A head trauma, maybe no trauma also, maybe the mother did not see the trauma also, and the child starts vomiting. So the child is usually taken to a pediatrician or a GP, and what they do is they give medicine for vomiting and send them back. And by the time the other symptoms like seizures or loss of consciousness or some other symptom starts, it's usually very, very late, and by the time it is a huge bleed that usually comes up. So these are bleeds which we need to be very worried about. Renal bleeds also, children should be ideally admitted and given bed rest, because if the less active that area is, the chances of healing it is better. And GI bleed also very dangerous at times, especially in adults, because by the time you start seeing blood in stools, you already would have lost around 1 liter or 1.5 liters of blood also at times. And many a times that if you don't go to a doctor immediately, it can be fatal. So these things are very, very crucial to recognize. And joint bleeds are the ones I told you, 80% bleeds are going to be joint and muscle bleeds. And if you don't take care, this is from a textbook picture, and these are how children are going to look like. They're going to have joint bleeds, muscles, wasted muscles and swollen joints. So whenever we suspect bleeding in a child, suppose the child with bruise came to me, what are the three things that I do initially? I do a platelet count, I do a prothrombin time, and I do an APTT test. So this is what we do initially. And in this whole group of bleeding disorders, what happens in hemophilia? In hemophilia, platelet count will be normal. Prothrombin time is also going to be normal, whereas activated partial thromboplastin time alone is going to be high. So this is going to be maybe 40 seconds or 60 seconds or maybe 120 seconds. These kind of reports come. Now, a couple of things on how to take a factor sample. So we usually use what is called a sodium citrate vial. This is a citrate vial that you can see. There is an anticoagulant called sodium citrate, and it's usually the vial comes with a citrate in it. And there is a mark on it on the other side, which tells you as to how much blood you should take. And we have to adhere to that level. We should not take more than that. We should not take less than that. So overfill or underfill, both of them are going to give wrong reports to us. That is one. Second, you should take it and you should do end-to-end inversions. What is end-to-end inversion? You take it in a tube and you do one inversion. This is one, two, three. That's enough. You don't need to aggressively shake it. This has to be taught to the nurses, because if you shake it with the contact itself, clotting can start and the report may be fallacious. So that also is important. Three, if a patient is admitted, you do not take it from a central line. If suppose you have a neckline or something for some purpose, never take APTT PT samples from a neckline, because if you have heparin in the line, that is going to raise the APTT. So that was also something which we should remember. Four, where will we take blood from? It should be from one of the big veins. So either you can use this vein or even the cubital vein if you can easily palpate it or see it. It should be a free flowing venipuncture. In older people, you can put a syringe and aspirate 2 ml or 2.5 ml. So that's all usually you need. Whereas in younger children, we take it from this, and you take it from a free flowing big vein. What you should not do is, like in newborn babies, we try to prick from here and we break the hub and take drop by drop blood. That should not be done. And if you don't squeeze the area to bring out blood, because all these things are going to give fallacious reports in our APTT. So these things have to be kept in mind while samples are taken. And one more important thing is transported samples. If the sample is going to be taken at one center, one hospital, and the sample goes to a lab which is, say, 4 hours away or 6 hours away, that can also give you wrong reports, especially if there is extremes of climate. So extreme heat or extreme cold, both can have problematic reports. So we generally tell them that if you take a sample, run it within 4 hours, ideally within 1 to 2 hours. And if at all you're not able to run it immediately, separate the plasma and send it. So if that would be easier. So you can immediately separate the plasma and send the plasma over for testing. That will give you better. And that is usually sent in dry ice so that the report is not wrong. Or if not, then send the patient only to that lab for testing so that the sample is taken right then and there instead of sending the sample, because samples are usually erroneous. And usually this happens with both PT and APTT. So out of coagulation reports which come from small labs, usually around 50-60% would be fallacious because of all these issues. When you repeat it, you find it that the children are maybe, it may be even normal also. And another thing is that if you have an anticoagulation, if you have a hematocrit which is higher, like pediatricians would know that newborn babies have a higher hematocrit. So if you're going to test a newborn baby, there is a calculation for that anticoagulation that is there, which needs to be used. So it is no longer the same, the volume of anticoagulation in this big vacutainer would be different from the one which we use it for newborn care. And finally, if you are interpreting a newborn baby, then you need to know the age-appropriate values as well. Because PT and APTT, both we know in newborn period, it will be slightly higher. The physiologically, it will be higher. Because we don't have vitamin K at birth. Vitamin K, physiologically, there will be deficiency of vitamin K. And because of that, your PT, APTT will be little prolonged. So always appropriately evaluate it against an age-appropriate nomograms. Nowadays, you have age-appropriate nomograms in textbooks also, and it is freely available also. So if you're evaluating small babies less than 6 months, always look at the age-appropriate range. The lab report will be wrong, because what happens to lab reports is that they are going to give you normal for adult only. They're not going to give you normal for pediatric population. So always look at that also before you brand it as abnormal report. So these are some things, if we keep in mind, we get a better report. Now coming to our scenario of isolated APTT prolongation. So you have only APTT which is prolonged. We know that it has to be from the intrinsic pathway or from the common intrinsic pathway alone. So intrinsic pathway alone, if you have only APTT prolongation, if you have APTT plus PT prolongation, then it would be either of these or the common pathway as such. Now, when you have APTT prolongation itself, the most common ones are, like I told you, factor 8 and factor 9 deficiency, and rarely even factor 11 deficiency. What happens in von Willebrand disease? Von Willebrand factor is a carrier protein, carrier for factor 8. So when you don't have von Willebrand factor, your factor 8 also gets cleared from the circulation. So because of that, they have factor 8 deficiency also in these children. So because of that, your APTT can be prolonged in these children as well. So these are the usual causes in children who are bleeding. And sometimes, rarely, if you have heparin contamination, lupus anticoagulation, all that can also cause isolated APTT prolongation. Now coming to, these are the investigations that you do. And now you diagnose it. So how do you, so if you have isolated APTT prolongation, what do you do next? Nowadays, what we do next is just we go ahead and do the factor assay. So if somebody comes to us, we have an APTT, say around 100 seconds. We will say, okay, run factor 8 first and then factor 9. Why? Because 8 is more common than 9. So if your 8 is, if 8 is coming is absent, then it is highly unlikely that there will be two diseases. So we save money on the factor 9 testing. That is one. Second, if you have a family history, like we always ask them, if there is somebody in the family, if we say a distant cousin also has say factor 9 deficiency, then you run factor 9 first. So then if there is a family history, definitely you ask for. So these are the assays. These are the tests that we done straight away. Earlier, you used to have mixing studies and age deaths of plasma. These are things which are available even now. Mixing studies easily available everywhere. So as in, if you have normal plasma and if you know how to do an APTT, if your APTT is 100 seconds, if you mix it 50:50 with somebody's normal plasma, and then that correction is there. So then if the correction is there, then you know it is a deficient factor. So then it has to be AB or von Willebrand disease. If there is no correction, then it is usually heparin or lupus anticoagulation. So that we know, that is something at a peripheral small hospital also it can be done. Mixing study can be done. And if you have access to age and adsorbed plasma, then you can even differentiate between factor 8 and factor 9 deficiency also. But it is quite tedious, so we generally don't use this now. We straight away get a factor 8 or 9 testing done. And many times, if it is 8 deficiency only, if the 8 level is low, then in these children, we test for associated von Willebrand, branding them as hemophilia, we test for von Willebrand disease also associated with it. Okay. I'm not saying associated, it's just that von Willebrand disease could be the disease. The factor 8 could be reduced because of von Willebrand disease. So always look for that also. So now we have diagnosed as hemophilia A or hemophilia B. Now, what are the other things that you need to know? that these children are going to have joint disease. So this arthropathy is some complication that is going to come up again and again. So we are going to screen them for arthropathy regularly. We are going to screen them for transmission-transmitted infections, because many a times they would have received, like that boy I told you, he would have received plasma. So whenever somebody has received plasma or cryoprecipitate anywhere, always rule out HIV, hepatitis B, hep C at one, the first visit. And subsequently, if you are receiving plasma products again and again, annually it has to be done. Nowadays, we hardly do give anything, any plasma products. So almost in our center, except for factor 7 deficiency and factor 13 deficiency occasionally, other than that, nobody else receives plasma. So none of our hemophilia A, B, BWD, none of them get plasma or cryoprecipitate. It's all managed with factor support, which we have been getting. And the third complication that you need to know is inhibitors. Inhibitors are some antibodies which develop in some patients with hemophilia. So that also is screened regularly in these children with hemophilia. So now we'll see how is factor treated. So this is a, remember the first child who had a joint bleed, who had an acute hemarthrosis in his joint. So if a child comes with this, other than factor support, what else are we going to do them? How are they going to come to us? They're going to come with pain, swelling. There can be a tingling sensation in the joint. The tingling sensation is called an aura. Aura is like the aura you get in before seizures. Similarly, aura is a feeling that you have something is going to happen. So that aura, many children have it. They'll tell you that I am going to get a bleed today. So that tingling sensation, once it starts in the joint, you can actually give them factor then also, because it's a chronic patient. You know the patient that is telling the truth. You can even tell them, agar ho rahi hai, toh aap laga lo, you know. So that kind of unusual sensation can be there. Then what you, if you feel the joint, you will feel warmth. You can feel tightness. And sometimes children who come for the first time, second time, even with the joint bleeds, I've seen children come with tense joint bleeds. They can come with fever also. So once in a while, we do see children, pediatric patients with hemophilia, joint swelling with fever. It is not septic arthritis. It is just a hemoarthrosis. So how do we differentiate? We just, even if we think that this is septic arthritis, for the first time, you can't do, if you do a CBC, it will be again high WBC count, neutrophilia will be seen. Orthopedicians will ask you for ESR, CRP, etc. All of them will not be diagnostic for a septic arthritis. So what do? We just give them factor. We give them factor, wait for 24-48 hours. If the factor is not, if the swelling is not subsiding and the fever is persisting, then we do an inhibitor screen. And if the inhibitor screen is also negative, then we tap and see what is it. And in my experience so far, we have tapped only one child, and that has also was just bleed only. Sometimes septic arthritis, sometimes joint bleeds can present with exactly like a septic arthritis. On the other hand, any child whom you diagnose, you should tell them that the joint swelling comes, you should come to us. You should not go to any other person. Why? Because if you see like a joint like this, or a parent, if you see this joint, no, they will think it is some joint disease. They don't attribute this to bleeding, because inko nishan nahi lag raha, dikh hi nahi raha na bleeding. So whenever there is a swelling, you should tell them that deep bleeds will not cause color on the skin. It will not come, it will not be green or blue or red or any color like that. It will be just a warm joint and a painful joint. So you should tell them to come here. Why I am saying is that I've had a child with von Willebrand disease, type 3 bleed. When she had her first joint bleed, the parents, very educated parents, thought it was an orthopedic problem and took the child to a hospital, and the orthopedician actually put a needle and aspirated blood. So that is so wrong, because if you're putting a bleed into such a closed needle into such a closed space, it can actually increase bleed. So that is, these are things that happen because the awareness is poor. So we have to tell the parents upfront. And many a times another complaint which comes from the parent societies is that the doctor did not know. So main sabko yahi bolti hu, कितना रेयर डिजीज है इसके बारे में एमबीबीएस में या एमडी में सिखाना, इतने डिटेल में सिखाना नामुमकिन है. तो अगर आप जिनको दिखा रहे हो या जो आप जिनको दिखाने जा रहे हो, अगर उनको पता भी नहीं है तो आप बुरा मत मानिएगा. आप उनको जो लिखित में दे रखी है वो उनको दिखा दीजिए. मेनी टाइम्स मोस्ट डॉक्टर्स वेयर दैट अ चाइल्ड इज बीइंग टेकन टू एक्चुअली कोऑपरेट वेरी वेल. वी इवन गिव देम अ नंबर इफ देयर इज एनी क्वेरी, द डॉक्टर ऑल्सो कैन कॉल एंड डिस्कस. So these things which we kind of make it so that the process is small. Even in our hospital, residents keep changing. So the new lot of residents will not know what to do. Many a times I've had residents who say that there was no bleeding, there was only swelling, madam. He was just telling bleeding, there was no bleeding. So that is because they fail to understand that this is actually a bleed. So this is how a hemarthrosis looks like. And in hemarthrosis, what is the problem? This first time you have a bleed, this bleed comes into the synovial cavity, you give treatment, the bleed resolves. But multiple times if this happens, this joint, the cartilage can start getting destroyed because there is blood, and blood has iron in it and free radicals in it. All those are going to be damaging. Oxidant damage happens to the cartilage, the synovial membrane, to the bone, and finally, if you don't treat bleeds properly, the bone ends up like this. And that is why I said these people will have difficulty in moving, contractures will develop, and this joint becomes either permanently swollen or loss of joint space will come finally once the cartilage is eroded, and it's extremely painful to move the joint, and it becomes, they are usually wheelchair bound by then. So this is something we should prevent. How can we prevent? By two ways. One, once a bleed comes, immediately treat so that it does not get into this step at all. So you have a small bleed which is coming here, immediately treat. For that, we have to have centers which are accessible to us. They have to come to us within half an hour, 1 hour, and get the factor 24 hours of the day. Another way of doing it is home therapy. If we have access to home therapy, we can give them factor for home use so that whenever bleed starts, they immediately get the treatment. Another way of preventing joint damage is by prophylaxis, which is a world over approved way of doing it. So when you have prophylaxis, you are constantly keeping factor level at a higher level. So then joint bleeds don't occur that frequently. And by doing that, by protecting the joint, we are going to prevent disability in these children. And then when you have a suspected bleed, like a kind of doubtful bleed, for example, a child, I just mentioned her to you, 3-year-old boy, repeated vomiting, managed with IV fluid, ondansetron, etc. Never, even though they told that it is a child with hemophilia, by the time the child, till the time the child was only having vomiting, the child received only this treatment, not factors. And by 24 hours later, he started developing seizures. And that is when they brought the child, and it was an IC bleed. Luckily, because it was outside, like subdural bleed, the child improved immediately. We had on the same day, we had another baby who was brought with an intraparenchymal bleed, and that baby did not survive. So many times, once in a year at least, there is one child we lose because the IC bleed is brought in very late to us. So whenever there is a doubt, so when a child comes, we have told all residents that if a child is brought with history of trauma, bed se gir gaya, ya kahi lag gaya. So always, you need not look for trauma outside. You need not look for any bruising outside. If the child is having any symptom like that, excessive cry, vomiting, child is not behaving properly, all these symptoms have to be told to the parents and ask them to watch for the next 2 weeks for any minor symptom. And if there is any doubt, always treat. And don't wait for a CT evidence for bleed to treat, because CT scan, even if the CT scan is inside the hospital also, it will probably take an hour for the reports or the scan film to be available. So that much delay should not happen. And in many centers, to get a CT, you have to send for, probably it will take 1 or 2 days. And so that kind of delay, if we keep waiting, that can actually be very, very deleterious. And this is another joint bleed, which I told you, like repeated episodes of bleeding. If you have a child who is coming to you again and again, always look for chronic arthropathy. And many times chronic arthropathy, you need physiotherapy under factor cover. That is more important than just giving only factors. So sometimes children are brought with repeated joint bleeds, as in one bleed and 3 days later again a bleed. Why is that happening? Because the joint is never recovering completely. So after one bleed has occurred, before the joint recovers or before physiotherapy is initiated, the second bleed has started. And that's how the joint gets damaged. And always in these patients, initiate prophylaxis and insist on aggressive physiotherapy. And that's how you can get out of this situation. And this is another bleed, iliopsoas bleed. So iliopsoas is a muscle which originates from this vertebral area. It comes down all the way and comes and inserts into the femur. So when you have a bleed here, what is dangerous here? one, femoral nerves are going here. You know? Because of that, if there is a bleed here, that can entrap the femoral vessels, and because of which it can cause femoral neuropathy. And because of that, quadriceps wasting occurs eventually. So how do you know if there is iliopsoas bleed or not? The child is going to come with pain in the groin area and limping and not able to. If you make them lie down and ask them to stretch the leg, they will not be able to stretch the leg completely. There will be hip will be kept flexed because they are afraid of stretching the leg. So that is iliopsoas bleeding for sure. And in these children, they should be put on complete bed rest for the next 5 to 7 days. And you should initiate them on factor support, a good factor support. Doses we will discuss in a bit. And physiotherapy. By day 3, when the pain subsides, we should start physiotherapy. So this is what is done. So goal of hemophilia treatment, for many of us, we started off with saving lives. We thought if we tell them, they will at least not die. And from there, we have come to saving disability. So even now, a lot of children who come to us, they don't have any disability. It's just that you have to teach them. And once they realize that the power of physiotherapy and the power of not having a joint bleed, no, then they will adhere to that exercise schedule very well. And now our emphasis is to give them a good quality of life so that they study well. And with help from NHM as well as from with help from hemophilia societies, they even get prophylaxis for exams, prophylaxis for any main activities, etc. So because of that, they don't have to miss any exams. They can go to school regularly. So this is the emphasis currently. You know? So we started from here, but now we are focusing on a good quality of life for these patients. And this kind of joints are something which we should prevent completely. So this is a team that is involved. It's never one person. The doctor, there is a nurse or one or two nurses who are actively involved in their care. So they know what to tell the parents also. A doctor, a musculoskeletal expert. All of us may not have dedicated orthopedicians. We may have to depend on an occupational therapist or a physiotherapist. And if we have a physiotherapist, that will be really, really good. A dedicated physiotherapist for them, that will also be helpful. Even I have seen many physiotherapists also are very, very afraid to treat hemophilia because they will say, ki aap movement karenge, to bleeding ho jayenge. I have seen physiotherapists giving wrong counseling. So that also with expertise only, it will come. So you have to teach the physiotherapist what to tell them so that slowly it improves. Then at times we may need a dentist. We may need geneticist. We may need, if you have received blood products, if you develop hepatitis, etc., you may need a gastroenterologist, etc. So these are from Western setups, but most of us require definitely doctor, nurse, a physiotherapist, a good laboratory, a psychosocial counselor, and a dentist. Definitely, these people should need not sit in the same room or same area. It could be several different places, but we should know whom to send if there is a problem. So that we have to see. So how do we treat them? We either treat them as episodic, means on demand, or we put them on prophylaxis. That's how we treat. And what do we give them for every bleed that we will discuss? So always we'll tell them avoid trauma, avoid drugs that affect platelet function like NSAIDs. You will not give them Brufen, Meftal, Ibugesic, etc. I have seen even surgeons or orthopedicians write Ibugesic very frequently. That should not be given. Brufen or that diclofenac like agents will increase, that will cause platelet dysfunction and that will increase the tendency for bleeding. So that should not be given at any cost. Good oral hygiene. They have to brush their teeth twice a day because gums, if they're healthy, teeth are healthy, bleeding comes down significantly. And of course, regular exercise. So this is how clotting factors came into being. Now we have mostly recombinant products available. And even the plasma-derived products that are available with us are of good quality. So we can safely give it to them. So these are the products that are available. And nowadays, we have even long-acting products also. So long-acting factor 8 and factor 9 are now currently available. Some of them are currently available in our country also. So if you have long-acting products, you don't need to give them very frequently. In factor 9, you can give them once in a week also. And factor 8, you can give them 2 times in a week also. Blood products we generally do not use, but if you are at a center where you don't have to, if you don't have anything else, then FFP or cryoprecipitate can be given. FFP is given at a dose of 15 to 20 ml per kg as a single dose, And but then problem is at this huge volume of 20 ml per kg, we are still not able to get a good hemostatic level of 30 IU per deciliter for factor 8 and 25 IU per deciliter for factor 9. So that is why we don't prefer. So suppose a child comes with bleed, for example, joint bleed, even if you give morning, evening, even still then you are not able to achieve this dose. So it's, first of all, it is not effective. And second, morning, evening, if you're giving 20 ml per kilo, that can cause volume overload definitely in a child. So avoid. And usually avoid. Second problem with FFP and cryo is that they are not viral inactivated. So if somebody gets it, if the donor was in the window period when you collected the sample, you have no way of finding it out. You have no way of inactivating the virus. So you can actually transmit infections like HIV. So the World Federation has been bringing out these guidelines for treatment. And this is the 2020 guideline that I have shown here. It is available freely internet access is there. And free access is there for this publication. You can look at that. It will tell you the doses of hemophilia A and hemophilia B. What we follow is the lower dose practice parameter usually. And joint bleed. So there is a calculation. There is a plan as to how to treat. So if you like saw the joint bleed, if a child is coming with a joint bleed, a severe hemophilic is coming, you need to correct, bring up the factor level to how much? 20 IU per kilo. So how will you bring up the 20 IU per kilo for 2 days? If you do that, the joint bleed usually settles. Similarly, muscle bleeds without any neurovascular compromise, again, 20 IU per deciliter for 2 to 3 days is enough. Whereas if you have ileocoas bleed, you need a longer cover, 20 to 40 IU per kilo initially, and then 20 IU per kilo for next 3 to 5 days. So this is the calculation that we follow. And how do we calculate the dose that we will see in a bit. In hemophilia B also, essentially the levels we need to achieve are the same. 20 in small joint and muscle bleeds, and ileocoas around 30 for the first 2 days, and then 20 again. What happens in other bleeds, intracranial bleeds, you need a higher factor percentage. We need to, in the first 3 days, we need 80 IU per kilo. And then you bring down the level to a maintenance dose for the next 2 weeks to around 40. And then another 1 week, you will give it around 30 to 50. So around how many days do you treat? If there is an IC bleed, total we have to treat for at least 21 to 28 days. So this is very, very important because most places they'll give 2-3 days factor, child is better, send the child home. What happens in that? Once you saw that bleed in that CT, once that bleed becomes smaller, that area, there is a cavity which is formed, and that cavity can have extra bleeding for the next 2-3 weeks till all the vessels heal in that area. There could be secondary bleed. So before you know it, in the next 1 month, the child will come back with a second bleed, and that second bleed may be worse than the first one. So always intracranial bleeds treated for 1 month, and first may higher doses need to be there only for the first 3-4 days. After that, you can bring down the doses. Similarly, airway bleeds, it will need around 1 week treatment. Again, doses are mentioned here. And GI bleed also needs around treatment for 2 weeks roughly. And that again, doses are mentioned here. Hemophilia B also, the average dose is similar. Duration is also similar. Only the calculation is different in A and B. Now, renal bleeds also, you take it up to around 40%. Surgery, if it's a major surgery, like child is undergoing a hip replacement, knee replacement, or an appendectomy, or ENT surgery. These kind of surgeries, you need a higher percentage. Whereas if it's a small IND or a dental procedure, etc., you can actually give the doses can be reduced further. So this is how that this is the plan of this thing. So this can be printed out, kept it on your in the emergency area. So all doctors posted there can actually quickly refer to it before you actually plan the treatment. Now, how do you give the treatment? So 1 IU of factor 8 will raise. So you wanted to raise, say we'll start with the joint. So if you want to bring it to 20%, so 1 IU of factor 8 will actually raise it by 2%. So if you want to give 20%, you give 10 IU per kilo. Very simple. So 10 kilo child, if you want to with a joint bleed, you have to give 100 IU minimum. So that is your calculation that you give. many a times, because your factor vial strength is only 250, we don't waste the vial. Even if you take it, if you dissolve it, it has to be immediately used within the next 4-5 hours. Otherwise, that activity comes down. So if you have another patient who requires at the same dose, then no problem. Otherwise, we'll just give it at a higher dose for this particular child. We'll probably give the whole one vial for that child. If it's an older child, say 50 kilos, 50 kilo child joint bleed, I have to give 500 IU. So that is the calculation. If I give 500 IU for a 50 kilo child, it will raise it by 20%. So that is the calculation that you have in your mind. What happens in 9? 9, it is the same. 1 IU will raise only by 1%. So you have to calculate exactly what you need. You don't need to make half of it. So if you have a 50 kilo child, if you have to raise it by 20%, you will have to be 50 into 20, that is 1000 IU, and 1000 IU of factor 9 has to be given. In our country, the current vial that is coming to us is 600 IU. So if you are getting a 600 IU vial, so you probably use two vials there. So that is 1200 IU. So that is how you calculate the dose in these children. And factor 9, one more word of caution, that once you give an infusion, especially in the initial few days, they can have allergic reaction, sometimes anaphylaxis also. So give it a little slowly, around 15 minutes or so. So if at all there is some itching or something that starts, immediately you can stop it. But other than this, whatever product is available in our country currently, there are no real allergic symptoms seen to the drug as such. Here it is happening because of factor 9 itself in the product, not because of the product of any company or things like that. So a lot of centers usually complain ki this product is causing problems, etc. Generally, when we see, we don't have much of issues if it's a good quality product. So that is the factor, the dose, and the site of bleeding. And other than this, we do some help. We tell them some things at home, that if there is a bleed, you have to give protection to the joint, you have to give rest, you have to apply ice, you have to compress with a crepe bandage or elastocrepe bandage, and you have to give elevation to that joint. So if it is a knee joint, you will have to do all this. So this thing now has been changed in the World Federation 2020 guideline as POLICE. Everything is the same, is that they have added one ONL, that is called optimal loading. Optimal loading means you are starting physiotherapy early. That is just that by day 3, you have to start putting load on the muscle. If you just leave it like that, it will be wasted and it will cause further damage to the joint. So that is again an emphasis on early and good physiotherapy for all patients with hemophilia. So I think I'm running too much, I've taken too much of time now. So I'll skip all this, this part, and I'll come to the last part. So this, most of it I've already discussed. So other than that, we have one drug called tranexamic acid. This is the dose of tranexamic acid that is again available freely with us. So for oral bleeds, GI bleed, and for girls with menorrhagia, this drug works wonderfully. You can use it. Dental bleeds, etc. You just have to crush and apply it locally. It will help in preventing bleeds. Whereas it is not helpful for joint bleeds or intracranial bleed, nothing, it will not work at all. And it should not be used in genital urine. If somebody has urinary bleed, do not use tranexamic acid. So that is something which we have to be careful, and we have to take care of their veins. We have to also advise regular physiotherapy. Something which on prophylaxis, we generally start prophylaxis by around 18 months of age, and after the first joint bleed occurs, and then you start giving them either twice a week or once a week prophylaxis initially for factor 8, and then slowly go up. So you ultimately end up giving them 2 to 3 times in a week. So this is how prophylaxis is given. These are the schedules that we follow. In our country, we follow low dose prophylaxis, which is around 10 to 15 IU per kilogram per dose of factor that is given. 30% of hemophilia A and 10% of hemophilia B develop inhibitors. So once in a year, we do check them for inhibitors, or if they are not responding to any bleed, or if they have a major bleed like a psoas bleed or a CNS bleed, we always check for inhibitors. And if you have inhibitor, then the treatment changes. You have to give them bypassing agents like FEBA and factor 7. These are the two bypassing agents that we use. We do not use factor 8 or 9 in these patients anymore. And there are new drugs which have come now, like non-factor replacement products like emicizumab, and even concizumab is coming into the market. So these are agents which are going to be helpful, and they are helpful more in patients with inhibitors. Although they are approved for both inhibitor positive as well as negative patients. So this is emicizumab, and this has been working very well in patients with inhibitors. And finally, one word, everybody asks if there is any permanent treatment for this. So there is genetic therapy, gene therapy, which is available in the West under study protocol. So therapy, the studies keep happening. A lot of issues keep coming once in a while. So it is not completely marketed as such right now. It is still under trial, but there are many companies which are there doing this trial. So we soon will have products which will be available in our country also. And I told you that we have to measure what we are doing. So what we are doing is a hemophilia activity list and health-related quality of life. We are monitoring for our patients. So even when you have patients, when you tell them that 2017, this is the activity list that you are doing, and 2018, now you can do this, that is kind of a confidence builder for these patients as well. Or if somebody is not improving, then also we know. We tell all mothers to undergo carrier testing, and all sisters also to undergo carrier testing. And if there is somebody who is a carrier, definitely prenatal diagnosis has to be done. So this is done chorionic villus sampling around 10 completed weeks, and amniocentesis is done around 12 weeks. And if somebody does not come to you at that time, then probably fetal blood sampling around 18-20 weeks. But by then the baby is fully grown, and if you decide on terminating, it will be a fully grown baby, and it will be difficult for both the family also to terminate the baby. So try and do it at this time, around 8 to 10 weeks of gestation. So I'll stop here. Usually we do not give factor prior to vaccinations. And nowadays everybody is asking regarding COVID vaccine. We can give COVID vaccine safely. We've had around 20-25 patients by now who have received the vaccine, and none of them have had a significant bleed. And I think I'll stop here. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Neeta. I would request the second speaker to please share his presentation. Can you switch a webcam also? Sir, your presentation is visible. Please go into slideshow mode and you can start.
Right, sir.
Slideshow mode.
So, good evening, everybody. Today, am I audible and my screen is visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Now I'll start. So, today I'm going to present the scenario of hemophilia in Himachal Pradesh. What we have there, we were discussing what are the facilities available there and what are the case detection till now. So before proceeding further, we'll see what are the hemophilia case detection or case load here in the Himachal Pradesh. In this case, before coming to the Himachal Pradesh, we'll have a just look on to the what is the scenario in India compared to the rest of the world. This is a presentation I have taken from one journal, Indian Journal of Medical Research. Here we see that there are different countries in the world, like USA, India, Brazil, China, and UK. If we see the detection rate or the prevalence there, UK is number one, where they are having 8.6 per lakh population. That's the hemophilia cases there. Then comes the Brazil, USA, Brazil, and in India, we are having 0.9 per lakh population, the detection of hemophilia. So, on this background, just see what are the scenario in Himachal Pradesh. So, Himachal, this is the slide is taken from there. They have given just the prediction. What is the predicted one and what are the, in the bracket we can see what are the predicted one based on the 4 per lakh population, the cases of hemophilia. So these are the different in the bracket one, and apart from this, the what are the actual been detected there. So coming to the Himachal Pradesh, BCA, take the census of 2011, we have something around 68 lakh so population of Himachal Pradesh, and this is the different area here. The Kangra has the highest one, that's the largest district as far as our population concerned, and they are different. So on this basis we will see what are the cases that has to be there and which are predicted to be there. So if we take the prevalence of 4 per lakh population, so in Himachal Pradesh we are expecting to have 274 cases. So this is the usual scenario should have been there. But what is actually there? So this is in the diagram we can see this was a predicted 274 based on the 4 per lakh population. So now in Himachal Pradesh at present, this is the data which we have taken from the Hemophilia Society, Registry of Hemophilia Society. Otherwise, we don't have any registry, authorized registry in the Himachal Pradesh, and sometimes it's become difficult that to find out the how many cases are there. And from this registry, some of cases may be here and there which are missed over there. But we have, as of now, 114 cases in whole of the Himachal Pradesh. So if we take, if you see the prevalence on the basis of our population, it comes out to be 1.68. So prevalence, or it is the detection rate what we are finding here, actual cases may be larger one. So it is better than the rest of the country, which is 0.9, but not as good as was expected of. So this is a scenario here. We can see what are the different distribution of the cases in Himachal Pradesh. In Himachal Pradesh, we have the largest district, that is the Kangra, where we have 25 cases. And then the number two are the Shimla and Mandi, we have 23 cases. And then Solan with 18 cases. And Sirmaur 7 cases, and Chamba with 5 cases. And then Una 4, and Hamirpur we have 3 cases from there. And in Kullu 2 cases, and 4 from Bilaspur cases. This may not be exact, but this is what is there in the registry we have. So if we see the what are the percentage, there are two districts here, like Kinnaur and Lahaul Spiti, where we do not have a case from there. Maybe somewhere else, but we don't have that case registered in the registry of Hemophilia Society. So if we see the distribution and the prevalence of the cases in different districts of Himachal Pradesh, we see that here the Shimla is with 2.8. But other than that, is Solan is the highest one, that is the 3.1 per million per lakh population we are detecting there. And then number two is the district Shimla, and then comes the district Mandi. Though in district Kangra we have 25 cases, but the population is also larger one, though it is only 1.6 per lakh populations. Then the Sirmaur also 1.3, and then Bilaspur 1.04. And there are few districts where it is less than the national detection rate, like Kullu, Hamirpur, and Una. So in overall, we have 114 cases, and it is a 1.68 per lakh population. The cases are there. And based on the observed estimated cases, the current prevalence is 1.68 per lakh population, and estimated cases are 274 cases. Still, we are very far behind the what is the expected out. This means we are missing like 160 cases are there. So which region may be many, they may not be coming to the hospital, or maybe treated somewhere else. Or there are many geographic constraints also, may not be reaching appropriately to the hospitals and are missed over there. So now the distribution of the cases of hemophilia A, B and other in Himachal Pradesh, as already been discussed by Madam in the earlier slides, A cases are the larger one. And here, if you go by district wise, so factor A deficiencies, they are the larger one here. 100 cases are there of factor A deficiencies and 11 cases are for the factor 9 deficiencies. There's one case of factor 10 deficiency and they are one Bilirubin disease and one factor 7 deficiency also. So overall, we have 100 cases of factor 8, that is hemophilia A, and factor 9 are 11 and factor 10 are 1, and one one Bilirubin and one is a factor 7 deficiency. And overall, we have 114 cases, and this is the distribution in the different districts of Himachal Pradesh. So here we can see the 88% are the hemophilia A cases, and then this is the 9% hemophilia B factor 9 deficiency. So what are the, now these are the case load in Himachal Pradesh, and coming to the second part, what are the facility for the diagnosis and treatment in Himachal Pradesh? Here hemophilia, the facility for treatment and diagnosis, this is present in all our medical colleges like that IGMC Shimla, RPGMC Tanda, Hamirpur Medical College, then Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru Government Medical College Chamba, and Near Chowk and Y.S. Parmar Medical College Nahan. And all these centers, they are receiving the factors from the state. There is one center in the Hima, that is the Dr. RKGMC Hamirpur, where we are receiving the aid from the HFI, and it has been recognized and accredited by HFI for receiving the aid, humanitarian aid of factors. So diagnostic facilities, as far as diagnostic facility, coagulation study and factor assays are there. In almost every part of the state, this is available in the outsourced labs in most of the centers. And almost all of the new medical colleges and some of the established ones also, they are not, may not be available there also, but they are present through the outsourced labs, SRL labs. So some difficulties definitely are there in diagnostic testing, also diagnostic studies also there. So the sources of the medicines, what we receive, that is a factor concentrate or factors. So there are two sources which are available there from where we are receiving the factors. One is from the state government. So now in base of state government, this will be dealt in detail by our next speaker also, what are the next program which are being launched there. But as of now, we have the factor 8 and factor 9, they have been included in essential drug list also. But because of some constraint or some like information, not available, availability of information, some issues always remain there of some government supplies. And second, the source of the supply, medicine supply or factor supply is, that is the Hemophilia Federation of India. And this is provide the factors on the humanitarian grounds or as humanitarian aids. And one of the center in Himachal Pradesh, that's the STC Hamirpur, is receiving the aid from HFI since 2020. And in 2020, yes, if you take into, this is the last college also to start as a hemophilia treatment center. So hemophilia treatment center was started in Hamirpur, Medical College Hamirpur, in 2020. They were late to start there. And these are some pictures you can show. First, one child, first time started the hemophilia treatment there, was inaugurated by then principal, Dr. Chauhan. And there afterward, we also started receiving the humanitarian aid from HFI from September 2020 onward. And till date, we have received more than 3 lakhs of units from HFI. So we are very thankful for that. And as far as HTC Hamirpur is concerned now, which is receiving the supply from hemophilia Federation of India also. So it is covering the area of Himachal, this district of Hamirpur, Unna, and Bilaspur as such, and few parts of Mandi and Kangra. As we have seen in the slide earlier, also though there were less cases from there, but the Phoenix area is more and more of the cases from Unna, and whole of this Unna, Bilaspur, and some part of Mandi, and these are coming to there. So we have 12 patients of hemophilia A and 2 patients of hemophilia B, which are under treatment in STC Hamirpur. And second, the treatment regarding the treatment protocols, what have been followed in Himachal Pradesh. So as we have earlier seen that what are the standard treatment protocols, because there are two main protocols like the prophylaxis and episodic treatments. So now it is, as has been already discussed by Madam in earlier speakers, that nowadays it is the prophylaxis which is the main line of treatment, as far as it has been mentioned in that is the third edition of World Federation of Hemophilia, which has said that now it is the quality of life that is more important, and for that we need to start the prophylaxis. And every patient can be started, and every patient has even a right to be on the prophylaxis. And if we calculate, this comes out to more cost effective than episodic treatment also. And the second one, which has been practiced there, is the emergency protocol and traditional, or that is called episodic treatment, or emergency, that is called on-demand treatment. So what is the scenario as far as treatment protocol in Himachal is concerned? So most of the places, as in other parts of the country also, it is the episodic treatment which has been followed over there. The reason are many, because there are main treatment protocol followed in every center in Himachal also. So because this has been for longer time, even using this one, we are used to this one. And second, the main concern in Himachal is also that when the government is providing us the medicine, that the factors, and they are providing for the emergency treatment only. So there is some confusion over there, can be started on the prophylactic or not. So this is one area of concern that most of our center in Himachal Pradesh are not in a position to start the prophylaxis treatments. And also there are few practical aspects also. They are far off the villages, difficult terrains, and geography is difficult, and it is not always very possible for a patient to come to the center. In for, as we know, for factor 8 deficiency for prophylaxis, at least twice a week has to come to the center. So these are few of the difficulties. And second, that the prophylaxis. So it has been very little use as of now. So till date, we in the hemophilia center, that is STC Hamirpur, we have started at least 2 patients on the this is prophylaxis treatment. So now we need to plan and need to start on the prophylaxis more of the patients. And then at a few word about the HTC Hamirpur. So here the episodic treatment that has been available for 24/7 for all the patients, as in other part of our state and other central also. And the prophylaxis treatment is, I've seen that one patient has been started with a smaller kit, and another, that is a prime prophylaxis. And second is on the secondary prophylaxis. Because we have received the treatment, the factors from the Hemophilia Federation also. So we can afford and we are able to start the prophylaxis there. And these 2 kits can have also consented to come, and they are nearby, and they we have started them on prophylaxis also. So now here again we have started the prophylaxis clinic also once a week in Fridays, and hemophilia, all the details are been kept over there. Regular follow-up and monitoring has been done in Hemophilia Treatment Center at STC Hamirpur. So now the management of complication and inhibitor testing, the scenario over there, we have seen what are the in the previous lectures, that what are the recommended one, what should be done. But what is the current scenario in Himachal Pradesh? What is it? As you know, the comprehensive hemophilia care center is the need of all, because this is not a disease which is to treat it by a single person over there. So we need a comprehensive team, a team which have a different specialty, including orthopedicians, physiotherapists has a very vital role there, hematologists and pediatrician. They have to work together and provide the complete care to the hemophilic patients. So this is our next wish, that we can start a hemophilia, comprehensive hemophilia care center in some of our centers in Himachal. Now the in vitro testing, that as per the protocol has to be done once a year, and but as of now in Himachal Pradesh we have some problem with the labs and the facilities are not there. So most of that present, most of the center doesn't have this facility of hemophilia, this in vitro testing. And here we are lacking behind. But in future we are planning to have more of this in consultation with the help of our local societies of hemophilia federations of Himachal Pradesh branch, Mandi and HFI. And this is one. This is our future planning, to start the comprehensive hemophilia care center in most of our centers and to work on the carrier testing in the family context and in vitro testing facility at the HTC levels. This was, and what are the constraints in all these cases? Constraints are that first, that the government guidelines in Himachal Pradesh as of now are for the on-demand treatments. So this is that I'll request our next speaker to kindly give the details on this one, that can, is there any planning for on prophylaxis also or not? That as of now there is a in letter which has said that is for on-demand or emergency treatments. So for prophylaxis we require more of the factors. Maybe the HFI can help us here. If we have one center in Himachal Pradesh, we require more of them. In other areas where we can, we have more of the patients and they will be benefited from this. And next point is that for follow-up investigations, at the government level, we need to have some policy, and there is also, there should have been some policy for investigation of the contact of patients. So these are some of the constraints as in the government sectors. So here we require from help from the government and society to take up these cases with the government. And then what are suggestions and requests from our side are that we need to have more of HFI-aided centers, because in Himachal Pradesh we have difficult terrains are there. We have difficult conditions are there. So more of HFI centers, if they are there, so they will be able to provide more of the prophylaxis treatment to the those who are needed there. And because prophylaxis, because this is a very difficult area, very far off, and it takes lots of time to travel, even 50 kilometers. So we need to start this hemophilia treatment center at the periphery levels, even at the district and block and PSC levels. So factor should be available on the periphery level so that we can treat them appropriately and start the prophylaxis there also. And another, which is a concern, a request to our society also, that we need to have the treatment protocols in the different centers in the various, there are some ambiguity, there are some differences there, they may not be as similar to all the places. So we need to have a standard treatment protocol of all our centers there. For that we need to have some SCMIs so that we can form a group and treat the appropriately the cases there. So with these words, I must acknowledge the help of Hemophilia Federation of India in conducting this webinar, as well as providing support to us. And I must also appreciate the efforts and the help of the Hemophilia Federation, Hemophilia Welfare Society, Mandi, especially Mr. Samar Singh Ji, is the general secretary to Hemophilia Welfare Society Mandi. Is very instrumental in starting the hemophilia treatment center at Hamirpur, STC Hamirpur, and also providing us the support from the Hemophilia HFI. So with this word, I thank you all, and over to all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Girish. I would request the next speaker, Dr. Hisham, to please share his presentation.
Hello, good evening all. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. First of all, I thank Hemophilia Federation of India, Mandi chapter, for giving me the opportunity to participate in this webinar from the National Health Mission. In the speakers, Dr. Neeta Radhakrishnan from the Super Specialty Hospital from Noida has done the excellent presentation on the clinical presentation and treatment protocols for the hemophilia patients. And the next speaker, Dr. Girish from Radhakrishnan Medical College, Hamirpur, has presented the disease burden in Himachal Pradesh and treatment facilities in the Himachal. I am presented on the future planning of the hemophilic patients at the government level for the welfare of the hemophilic patients. In Himachal Pradesh, as the data is taken from the Hemophilic Federation Mandi chapter, in that data, we may find some missing patients. So it is estimated that there are around 125 patients are getting treatment from hemophilia, and patients have been reported from all districts except in our hospital. Kangra district has the highest number, being the largest population. Thalassemia screening and diagnosis in health facilities is free under the free diagnostics. And the treatment is available in all government hospitals and some district hospitals free, as the factor 8 and 9 required for treatment are a part of EDL, which is to be provided free to the patients as per the government policy. In the near future, we have planning to start the prophylactic treatment for the hemophilic patients as per the initial discussions with the higher authority. Daycare centers in the medical colleges will be strengthened with the dedicated beds for the patients of hemoglobinopathies. In addition to the hemophilia treatment, we are also focusing on the thalassemia patient screening and diagnosis in the health facilities as it is kept under free diagnostics. As per the national guidelines of 2016 for diagnosis and treatment of hemoglobinopathies, health institutions, medical colleges are being strengthened and the equipments are being procured. For screening of thalassemic traits in schools, children of class 7 to 12 will be done, and the tender process is being done as outsourced agency for conducting the collecting the samples and reporting the of the samples. Carrier screening and genetic counseling of couples for prevention of births of hemophiliacs. Creating awareness in communities through mass media, print media, and social media. We are also, we should also focus on the educating the patients for avoiding the injuries. Next, we are planning to sensitize our health staff on hemophiliacs through departmental trainings. Next, I would like to hear from the physicians and the patients regarding the problems in providing the care and various gaps in the health services, so that we can improve our services to the hemophilic patients and other patients of suffering with the hemoglobinopathies. Thank you.
We have received a few questions from the audience, which I put in the chat. So I would request the two speakers, Dr. Neeta, to please go through the questions and give the answers.
Shall I start?
Yes, ma'am.
So the first question is from Yamuna Nair. The question is, which AHF is better, plasma-derived or recombinant, and why? And the same person has another query, whether we should use Hemlibra for non-inhibitor patients or not. Okay. So regarding plasma-derived versus recombinant, I did touch upon it a bit during my presentation. So traditionally, plasma-derived, when it started off, like when it was being used a couple of decades back, at that time, there were some cases where plasma-derived resulted in infections, as in that there was contaminated plasma that was used. But subsequently, the degree of safety with plasma-derived is very good. And even in the last decade or so, there have been no cases reported from any country, for that matter, with HIV transmission, hepatitis B or hepatitis C. What is the difference between in current date, if you ask, between plasma derived or recombinant, what is the difference? The difference is in the availability, the scalability. So recombinant, since it is being marketed inside, it's been produced inside a factory without any plasma requirement at all. If you need 1,000 vials, they can produce 1,000 vials and give it to you immediately. Whereas plasma derived, you need human beings as in donors, you need them to donate, you need that donation to be tested. All that process takes a little time, effort for the companies. So at times it becomes a little difficult to scale up if it is required. Safety wise, plasma derived is quite safe nowadays. And even now there is data coming that plasma derived may be actually good also in some conditions, like von Willebrand containing factor VIII might be better than recombinant factor VIII. So, but that is a completely different discussion. So I would not say one product is better over the other, but recombinant products are usually available in most states now. And even if it's plasma derived, it's usually good quality. And World Federation has some criteria which is being satisfied by most of the companies that are marketing it. So that should be looked into. If you are getting a plasma derived product, make sure that the quality is good. The second question was regarding Hemlibra use. So Hemlibra is emicizumab. It is approved for both naive hemophilia as well as inhibitor positive hemophilia. So without inhibitors also we can use it in factor VIII patients. We have been using in essentially in only inhibitor positive patients, because for the other patients we are using factor VIII anyway. One or two patients who live very far away, like a boy who goes to a college in a hostel, he stays in a hostel and he's on prophylaxis, he gets reimbursement through his father's employment, this thing. So he has been using it. He is not an inhibitor positive person, but he has been using it, and it can be used in other patients, in patients without inhibitors also. Next question, I'll read it out, Dr. Girish.
Yes, ma'am, I'll answer this. Next question is from Indu Wala, Himachal, Jawali. So our question is, what are the facilities for hemophilic patient in Himachal? So as I have discussed already in the slide, but I'll again revise it. So just Anuwala ji, jo aapka agar aapki dekhte hain Jawali, it is I think nearby Kangra. So Kangra mein jo Dr. RKGMC RPGMC Tanda mein ye facility available hai aur factors hain, factors mil jate hain, factor 8, 9 both. और हिमाचल में अगर नियर बाई है तो जैसा हमारा आरपीजीएमसी हमीरपुर है, आरकेजीएमसी हमीरपुर मेडिकल कॉलेज है, तो वहाँ भी हमारे पास ये अवेलेबिलिटी है, फैक्टर्स की अवेलेबिलिटी है। और इसके अलावा मंडी में भी है तो आपके नज़दीक ही है, और सेंटर जो हमारे सारे मेडिकल कॉलेज में हर इसमें जो है ट्रीटमेंट फैसिलिटी अवेलेबल है। सो दैट्स ऑल फॉर अनुवाला। एंड next question,
can a hemophilia transmit from father to son? No, father to son not directly, father to mother, daughter, and from daughter to the next generation it can come in the son. So that we discussed in there. The next question was
Vivek Kumar, Himachal Pradesh. So he written ki mere left knee mein andar ki taraf चलते समय जरा सा ठोकर लगते ही प्रॉब्लम होती है, अगले दिन चलना बिल्कुल मुश्किल हो जाता है। तो स्वेलिंग तो नहीं होती, पर बोन में दर्द होता है। तो इसका जैसे ऑलरेडी डिस्कस हो चुका है क्वेश्चन कि अगर ऐसा कुछ हो रहा, थोड़ी सी दर्द से हो रहा है, तो आपको नजदीक जहां भी है, अगर आप किसी मेडिकल कॉलेज है हमारा, वहां आके हीमोफीलिया के लिए एक जो भी, अगर आप बच्चा है तो पीडियाट्रिक्स डिपार्टमेंट है या वो भी है, तो हीमोफीलिया के डायग्नोसिस उसके करना जरूरी है, तो उसके लिए इन्वेस्टिगेशन करना पड़ेगा। इसमें आप दिखा लें मेडिकल कॉलेज में भी, क्योंकि ऐसे कहना बड़ा मुश्किल है कि क्या, पर जैसा आपने प्रॉब्लम बताई है, इससे लगता है कि इसे स्वेलिंग है, तो ये भी एक सिम्टम होता है, जैसे मैडम ने ऑलरेडी डिस्कस किया कि जरूरी नहीं ब्लीडिंग हो, सिर्फ सोजिश भी होती है हीमोफीलिया में। अभी कहना मुश्किल है, पर हो सकता है, इसके लिए आपको एक बार आके हॉस्पिटल में जांच करवानी पड़ेगी। सो आई थिंक दिस इज ऑल। मैडम, यू वांट टू ऐड समथिंग?
नो, आई थिंक लॉट ऑफ चिल्ड्रन पेशेंट्स कंप्लेन ऑफ क्रेपिटस, जैसे ब्लीड ठीक हो जाने के बाद भी आवाज आती है तो लोग डरते हैं फैक्टर का फिजियोथेरेपी देने में, करने में, क्योंकि उनका लगता है कि जो कड़कड़कड़ आवाज आ रही है अंदर, वो एक्चुअली कुछ बोन में प्रॉब्लम है और दोबारा ब्लीडिंग शुरू होने वाला है। सो दैट क्रेपिटस हैपेंस, इट्स अ नॉर्मल थिंग। सो वो उसको उसके वजह से डरने की जरूरत नहीं है, तो फिजियोथेरेपी करते रहना जरूरी है। और नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज, इफ एमरजेंसी फैक्टर 7 नॉट अवेलेबल फॉर फैक्टर 8 इनहिबिटर पेशेंट्स, how much factor 8 recombinant needed, how many times can it be repeated? I didn't understand the question, Vinod Kumar. I'll just answer you, since you are from Andhra, I'll answer in English. If emergency factor 7 is not available for factor 8 inhibitors, then you can give FEBA. That is the only other product, factor 8 inhibitor bypassing activity. So FEBA is available. So these are the only two bypassing agents that are available in our country. And now there is semisuzumab or Hemlibra. You will not use factor 8 in patients who have factor 8 inhibitors. It will not work. So even if it is not in emergency, even if it is 7 is not available, you cannot go back and get 8. That is not helpful. I think that was the question.
So next question is from Pankaj, Himachal Pradesh. His question is, weekly necessary factor 8? I think he is asking twice weekly dose. हाँ, अगर देखो प्रोफिलैक्सिस की जहां तक बात है पंकज जी, प्रोफिलैक्सिस फैक्टर 8 के लिए रिकमेंडेड ये है कि ट्वाइस से वीक जो है, जो एक्सटेंडेड हाफ लाइफ वाले फैक्टर्स हैं उसमें ट्वाइस से वीक देना रिकमेंडेड है। तो प्रोफिलैक्सिस के लिए फैक्टर 8 के लिए यही है, पर एटलीस्ट जितना भी अवेलेबल, जो अगर इमरजेंसी में तो जब वो उसी टाइम पर, आई थिंक क्वेश्चन प्रोफिलैक्सिस के ऊपर ही है, तो ट्वाइस से वीक ही रिकमेंडेड है, जो आइडियल है।
कभी कभी हम शुरुआत में वंस अ वीक भी शुरू करते हैं, बट यूजुअली 2-3 टाइम्स अ वीक की जरूरत पड़ती है। नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन वाज रोहित मेहरा, भोपाल, हाउ टू क्योर टारगेट जॉइंट विद लो डोज प्रोफिलैक्सिस। with physiotherapy. That's the only way you can get your target joint back, by physiotherapy. You need a good cover of factor, definitely. तो फैक्टर के साथ आप डेली फिजियोथेरेपी करो. ये फिजियोथेरेपी शुड नॉट बी इक्वेटेड टू एनी मेडिकल सर्विस. ये तो आपको डेली घर में करने वाली बात हो गई ना. आपको छोटे बच्चे हैं तो माँ बाप को साथ में बैठ के करना होगा. बच्चे को बोलेंगे जाके फिजियोथेरेपी करो, कोई भी बच्चा नहीं करेगा. तो फिजियोथेरेपी नाम ही जरूरी नहीं है. यू कैन जस्ट कॉल इट एक्सरसाइज या फिटनेस के लिए जो आप घर पे करते हो वो रखना, पर लाइफ लॉन्ग करना है. ऐसे करते हैं तो जॉइंट्स, टारगेट जॉइंट्स रिवर्स होती है. इवन वी हैव पब्लिश्ड आल्सो दैट अच्छे फिजियोथेरेपी से वी हैव टारगेट जॉइंट्स को भी मिटा सकते हैं. दैट इज रिवर्सल ऑफ टारगेट जॉइंट्स कैन हैपन.
नेक्स्ट इज प्रोया आर ठाकुर फ्रॉम मंडी हिमाचल प्रदेश. इज देयर एनी क्योर फॉर दिस हीमोफीलिया एवर? तो ये तो जैसे पहले मैडम ने डिस्कशन में बता ही दिया कि मैडम यू वांट टू ऐड समथिंग कि इट इज एन इन्वेस्टिगेशनल की जीन थेरेपी हो रही है बट एज ऑफ नाउ नहीं है, बट आगे हो सकती है ना. मैडम यू कैन ऐड समथिंग.
आ जाएंगे, वो थोड़ा सा मुझे लग रहा है फ्रस्ट्रेटेड क्वेश्चन था, वो आ जाएंगे, वरी मत करो. पर उसका सोच के अभी का इलाज रोकना ठीक नहीं है. अभी आपको करना है, अभी जो करना अवेलेबल है उसको करना है. और प्रज्ञा, सिचुएशन नाउ इज मच मच बेटर देन इट वाज 10 इयर्स बैक, है ना. मिस्टर समर सिंह बता सकते हैं ना. आपने जब आपका शुरू हुआ होगा काम 20 इयर्स बैक, ये सब बिल्कुल होता नहीं था, है ना. तब से लेके अभी में बहुत फर्क आई है हीमोफीलिया में. तो आगे की लाइफ भी अच्छा ही रहेगा. और अच्छे से करते रहिए. लो बच्चे पढ़ रहे हैं, मतलब अच्छे अच्छे प्रोफेशन में है, तो फैमिली है उनकी आगे सब. लो आप जानते भी होंगे ऐसे लोगों को. तो ये मत करिए कि क्योर के ऊपर मत जाइए. क्योर आएंगे, अगर इसी जनरेशन के बच्चों को दिखनी चाहिए, क्योर आनी चाहिए हमारे कंट्री में. बट वही है कि जब आएंगे वो आएंगे, बस उसको सोच के अभी का ट्रीटमेंट रोकिए मत.
डेफिनेटली डॉक्टर नीता राधा कृष्ण जी, आपने बहुत सही बात कही. अगर हम 10 साल पहले देखें और आज को कंपेयर करें तो एक बहुत ड्रास्टिक चेंज इज देयर. सो ऑल कैडेट्स गोज टू अवर हेल्थ प्रोवाइडर्स
गवर्नमेंट,
डेफिनेटली एक बहुत बढ़िया है. और आज जितने भी जो मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज है, फैक्टर अवेलेबिलिटी है, उनसे हमारे जितने जो पर्सनल विद हेमोफिलिक्स है उनकी लाइफ एक बहुत ही कंफर्टेबल एक जोन तक पहुंच चुकी है. मोस्टली जो हम इस प्रेजेंट जनरेशन के जो पेशेंट बच्चे देख रहे हैं वो बिल्कुल विदाउट जो है उनके कैपल ज्वाइंट्स हैं, बिल्कुल हेल्दी ज्वाइंट्स हैं, अपने नॉर्मल उनकी तरह जो है काम कर सकते हैं. दे कैन ड्राइव द कार, दे कैन डू व्हाट ए नॉर्मल पर्सन कैन डू. सो डेफिनेटली देयर इज वेरी गुड चेंजेस.
डॉक्टर गिरीश,
नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज आशुतोष शर्मा फॉर जिंद. क्वेश्चन इज कैन लॉन्ग एक्टिंग फैक्टर आल्सो inhibitor, I mean also cause inhibitions, inhibitors. I think that is the question. So,
any factor can cause inhibitor, long acting or others. It is just that exposure days के ऊपर आप calculation देखना होता है. I think there is one more question on inhibitor testing, वो मैं अभी ले लेती हूँ. How frequently should we screen for inhibitor? Nivedita Sharma का question है. So, जब भी आप factor लगाना शुरू करते हो तो एक दिन में, जो एक दिन में जितने भी लगते हैं उसको बोलते हैं, चाहे दो बार भी लगते हैं, वो एक दिन को आप एक एक्सपोजर डे गिनते हैं. तो ऐसे अगर आप प्लाज्मा क्रायो जो भी लगता है उसको भी एक्सपोजर डे गिनते हैं. अगर ऐसे कैलकुलेट करेंगे, जब से बच्चे को डायग्नोस होके लगना शुरू हुआ तब से लेके पहले के 50 एक्सपोजर डेज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर इनहिबिटर जनरेशन. तो उस 50 में अगर इनहिबिटर नहीं बना तो आगे इनहिबिटर बनने का चांस 1% है. मतलब 100 में से एक आदमी को ही बनेगा आगे. पर ये जो 50 के अंदर 100 में से 30 लोगों को बन सकती है, 30% रिस्क है. और ये जो 50 में भी फर्स्ट 20 एक्सपोजर डेज बहुत जरूरी है. और वो 20 एक्सपोजर डेज में एज पर गाइडलाइन एवरी 3 एक्सपोजर डेज में हमें टेस्ट करने की जरूरत होती है. वो 3 एक्सपोजर डेज कभी कभी मुश्किल हो जाती है, तो हम एटलीस्ट 5 to 7 एक्सपोजर डेज में एक बार कराते ही है, जस्ट टू सी स्क्रीन फॉर इनहिबिटर्स. So that is how we routinely test, and whatever you use, long acting factor or standard half life factor, un sab mein inhibitors ka chance rehti. It is not related to the factor, it is related to the child. Child respond kaise kar raha uske upar hai.
So next is Rakesh Kumar, Mandi, Himachal. How does a woman know that she is a carrier? So carrier, एक तो कैरियर जहां भी, एक तो अगर उसका बच्चा है उसी में हम देखते हैं कि वी सस्पेक्ट कैरियर है या उसके रिलेटिव में देखते हैं, तो उसकी कैरियर टेस्टिंग जो है वही जेनेटिक टेस्टिंग या वही करनी पड़ेगी. मैडम यू लैड इट है.
कैरियर टेस्टिंग के लिए वैसे तो यू नो यू कैन नॉट नो वेदर यू आर अ कैरियर और नॉट, है ना. अगर आपके फैमिली में तीन सिचुएशंस में आपको पता है कि आपको टेस्टिंग के बिना पता चल सकती है. एक, अगर आपके दो बच्चों को हीमोफीलिया हुई है तो पक्का आप कैरियर हो, तभी आपके दो बच्चों को हुई है. अगर आपके एक बच्चे को हुई है और आपके फैमिली में किसी और को है, जैसे आपके ब्रदर को है या आपके मामा को है या आपके पापा को थे, ऐसे है तो भी आप पक्का कैरियर हो. तीसरा, अगर आपके फादर है, आपका फादर अफेक्टेड है, तो सारी लड़कियां कैरियर ही होंगे. तो ये तीन सिनेरियो को हम ऑब्लिगेट कैरियर्स बोलते हैं. तो इनको हमें वैसे टेस्टिंग की जरूरत नहीं है, हमें पता ही है वो कैरियर है. और एनीवे प्रीनेटल के टाइम पे हम सैंपल तो भेजते हैं, एक बार जांच जरूर करते हैं, पर हमें एनीवे पता है कि ये लोग कैरियर है. बट सिम्टम के ऊपर कोई बोलेंगे मुझे आज तक ब्लीडिंग में नहीं होगा, मैं कैरियर नहीं हूं, ऐसे नहीं पता चलेगा. और दूसरा, फैक्टर टेस्टिंग के ऊपर भी नहीं पता चलेगा. फैक्टर टेस्टिंग करोगे आप, मुझे मेरा फैक्टर 70% आ गया तो मैं कैरियर नहीं हूं, वो भी नहीं बोल सकते हैं, है ना. तो हमें जेनेटिक टेस्टिंग करा के ही फैक्टर है कि हमें हमारी कैरियर स्टेटस पता चलेगी, है ना. और बाकी सब लोगों को कैरियर टेस्टिंग अपना करके रखना जरूरी है, स्पेशली अगर आप अगला प्रेगनेंसी प्लान कर रहे हो, है ना. और सारे जो हीमोफिलिक बॉय है उसकी जितने भी बहने हैं उनको भी टेस्टिंग कराना जरूरी है. जब कभी कभी मदर का पता नहीं है तो भी मदर की सिस्टर्स हैं और उनकी भी शादी अभी हुई नहीं है, तो हम उनको बोलते कि आप अपना भी करा लो और अपनी बहनों को भी करा लो शादी होने से पहले, ताकि आपको अगले नए जनरेशन में ये प्रिवेंट कर सकते.
ऑलरेडी आंसर्ड मैडम.
हाँ, अभी आई थिंक वो पिक लाइन वाला क्वेश्चन है.
काइंडली गाइड फॉर द इंसर्शन ऑफ पिक लाइन फॉर पेशेंट ऑन फैक्टर 8 प्रोफिलैक्सिस एंड हाउ लॉन्ग इट कैन बी केप्ट.
पिक लाइन्स जनरली वेस्टर्न कॉन्सेप्ट है, सेंट्रल लाइन डाल के प्रोफिलैक्सिस देना. हमारे कंट्री में प्रोफिलैक्सिस में हमें अभी तक सेंट्रल लाइन्स की जरूरत नहीं पड़ी है. तो आईटीआई जब देते हैं, विच इनहिबिटर की जो ट्रीटमेंट है उसमें डेली फैक्टर लगते हैं, कभी कभी उसमें सोच सकते हैं. बट अदरवाइज हमें अभी तक पिक लाइन की या कोई भी सेंट्रल लाइन की जरूरत नहीं पड़ी है. अगर आप लगा रहे हो पिक लाइन तो यूजुअली पिक लाइन स्टे फॉर अराउंड 6 months और सो, उससे ज्यादा आप नहीं रख सकते. और उसमें भी रूटीन केयर चाहिए होगा, वीकली ड्रेसिंग्स और वो सब भी चाहिए होगा. तो वो काफी मेहनती प्रोसेस है, उसको आगे चला के ठीक से रखना भी, दैट इज ऑल्सो इक्वली इम्पॉर्टेंट. और यूजुअली वेस्टर्न कॉन्सेप्ट है. अभी हमारे यहाँ पे बच्चों में वो इनिशियल 1.5-2 years में ही डॉक्टर गिरीश एग्री करेंगे कि कैनुलेशन में थोड़ा दिक्कत है, उसके बाद आराम से कैनुला मिल जाएंगे. और बच्चों को भी हम बोलते हैं कि ऐसे वाले वो जो बॉल वाले एक्सरसाइज करे ताकि ये वाले नस अच्छे रहे. और इवन क्यूबिटल वगैरह में तो सब बच्चों को बता रखे हमने कि 2-3 veins आप अपना डेवलप करके रखो, और वो वेन्स में अगर इमरजेंसी में वो वेन्स के लिए रखो, है ना. ताकि ये सेल्फ इन्फ्यूजन सिखाते वक्त सिखाते हैं कि 1-2 vein आपको पता होना चाहिए कि 100% उसमें लग जाएगी, ताकि इमरजेंसी सिचुएशन में आपको भागने की जरूरत नहीं है.
नेक्स्ट इज अंजु मेहता फ्रॉम शिमला. क्या हिमाचल में फैक्टर 9 और इनहिबिटर फैक्टर उपलब्ध है? हाँ, फैक्टर 9 तो उपलब्ध है, हर जगह है, पेशेंट कम है, बट फैक्टर 9 तो अवेलेबल है ही है. इनहिबिटर आई डोंट नो, क्या क्वेश्चन है, सो आई कुडंट अंडरस्टैंड. इनहिबिटर फैक्टर्स
फीबा और फैक्टर 7
दैट इज नॉट अवेलेबल. फीबा इज नॉट अवेलेबल, और फैक्टर 9 अवेलेबल है. फैक्टर 9 अवेलेबल है, हर सेंटर्स में है. सो दैट्स ऑल. थैंक यू मैम.
थैंक यू. Anand, we've finished it.
कि हम फ्यूचर में भी आपकी जो है वो सेवा लेते रहे, तो वंस अगेन मैनी मैनी थैंक्स टू यू ऑल. थैंक यू. थैंक यू.
थैंक यू एवरीवन. आई एम एंडिंग द वेबिनार नाउ. थैंक यू एवरीवन. बाय एंड गुड नाइट.
ओके सर.
थैंक यू.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर गिरीश. थैंक यू डॉक्टर ऐशन. थैंक यू सो मच.
थैंक यू.
थैंक यू.
थैंक यू.